everyone, welcome to another exciting episode of The Velvet Room.
Hello.
Whoa. Turning my audio gain down ever so slightly because I realize I'm peaking the mic.
Oh.
I'm your host, Mitch. What up?
Hey, I'm your co-host, Sora.
And I'm your podcast editor, Resident Weave Josh.
Yeah. And am I co-host? Is that... I kind of just gave a title on the fly.
Yeah,
is
no,
that,
no, is that, it's is okay. That, yeah, no, is that right? That's fine.
The titles okay. Work.
I can be sub-host if you want, or, like, no. Mini-host.
Yeah, no, you are what I like to call... You're the garbage host. That's
first-hand... Right-hand host. I don't know.
The right-hand
garbage
host.
Garbage host is fine. I can do that. All right.
God. All right, so before we get started on today's episode of the podcast, I just wanted to give a shout-out to our fake sponsor... Crunch and Bunch.
Oh, what? I thought it would be Marvel Unlimited again.
Yeah, exactly. they've.
But it's certainly given you at least two or three hours of podcast topics.
The literal thought process was I should do the Marvel Unlimited thing, and then halfway through saying it, it's like, wait, no, they're probably going to call me out on that. I should change that the last minute.
Well, I mean, by the looks of it, we'll have at least another hour.
What the fuck is Crunch and Munch?
I have no idea. I was trying to come up with something on the spot, and it just fell
it's
apart.
Like Loot Crate plus Crunchyroll.
It looks like a knockoff snack. It looks like a grocery store brand Cracker Jack. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, no. Is that a thing? Is that real?
That's what I googled.
Fuck. We are not affiliated with Crunch and Munch.
All right. Well,
we totally are though.
This podcast is already derailed 2 minutes in. It doesn't take
us
long.
All right. Hey, okay. So everyone, hey. So let's talk a little bit about announcements before we get started on today's episode of the podcast.
Oh yeah.
So first things first, Gang Mudo. Channel, former channel host Gang Mudo says hi, and also, we might be doing some things in the future. I'll keep you updated on that. It's actually really exciting. I just actually came back from hanging out with her for a bit, so it was really good to catch up and stuff. And then, she asked me to make a very specific thing that I actually wanted me to make, to address to the dweebs in the Discord, because apparently she says, and I'm quoting here, it's wrong. So, there is 4 Bs that I'm into, apparently. And the 4 Bs are blondes, blue hair, butts, and boobs. Apparently that is the 4 Bs. That is the actual thing.
To be fair, the second 2 Bs, butts and boobs, that's like...
That's not exactly a unique... Like,
exactly, that's not a unique qualifier right there.
No, I know it's not. I know, but it was very pertinent.
The 4 Bs, like, though. It's easy to remember. It's catchy. It's a good... good acronym.
No, I mean, every man is into butts.
Good breakdown. You should just put that on your Tinder. 4 Bs.
The 4... Yeah, no, that's how that's
must
how
have
it
three
works.
Of the four.
That's how it works.
Oh, my God.
Speaking if you have Tinder, all of the four.
Speaking of Tinder, time to expose... Sora on stream.
What?
Hey.
Oh,
hey,
what the fuck? Don't do that, man. That ain't cool.
It's totally cool. It's for entertainment.
It's
man.
Fine. No one will ever see me unless they're in the area that I live in, which I haven't divulged yet. So that's fine.
Oh, yeah. No, it's magic. You live in Asgard, right?
And
that's
you don't,
how it is.
Yeah, that's true. And no one, you can't record your voice on Tinder, as far as much as I'm aware of. So there you go. No one will know who I am. I remain anonymous.
Really, that sounds really misleading. Like, someone can have a real shit voice.
What a shit voice! Like, send me. You're just on Tinder, and then you're just like, send me recordings of your voice, so I know that you don't have a shitty voice.
Like someone's like super hot, right? Like you see someone, and it's like Prompto or Gladiolus or Noct, and it's like they have the voice of Danny DeVito, and it's like,
You're acting like that's not a plus. I don't understand, guys. That would be great. That would be a done deal right away.
Sora, do you want to have sex with Danny DeVito?
The rum ham. Yeah.
How did I forget about the rum ham?
Don't forget about the rum ham. I can't. I'm not even going to try to do a Danny DeVito Frank impression, but goddamn, that man is a legend. Anyways.
Yeah, all right. So welcome to the podcast, everyone. We gotta start going in. So who wants to tag first? Who wants the first subject?
I guess I should go first because I need to explain myself.
Yes, indeed.
As to why I haven't been here recording, and it's just because basically, these last few weeks have been pretty crazy with, you know, staying home for the holidays and stuff like that. We all kind of took a mini break there and hung out with Mitch and, you know, got some stuff done. And that was cool. But not last week, I had to bail because I was at MAGFest. Yeah. That was really awesome. I ended up, it was kind of a last minute thing. I like had a big group of friends that they had an open spot in their hotel room. And yeah, I was able to just kind of pack up my shit and go for the whole weekend. It was awesome. The whole 4 days. That was the first time that I stayed at a convention for the full, like, Thursday through Sunday, the whole kit and caboodle. Usually our MO, at least with the early days of ColossalCon, we had to only do like Saturday, right? Because, like, you know, our parents had to drive us and then we had to pick us up at the end of the day, right? So that was sweet. And then we also stayed at the Gaylord National, which is like the actual convention hotel. So super convenient, except for the fact that the elevators were always backed up. It was like a 10-minute ordeal to just get an elevator to ride down to the ground floor, just because, oh my god, and people were drunk, and it was rough. There's elevator parties.
You forgot the first rule of cons.
Which is what?
Don't stay in the main hotel. I mean, there's the pluses of it, but like on Saturday nights and Friday nights, like that is a garbage.
Oh, scenario. But it was so worth it though, dude. Oh my god, you like a like I got I drank enough that I had like the drunken rage to just kind of run up the stairs. We were on the 10th floor and it was totally fine. Just kind of, you know, did a light jog up the stairs when I needed to grab something. But, yeah, I don't know. It was fine. It was awesome, actually. Like, way more convenient because, like, the only other hotels nearby. I guess there's a residence in, right across the street, but it looks pretty small. But anyways, it was great. It was my first MAGFest. My first con in general without Mitch, so that was a little weird, to be honest with you. but the group that I went with, we were way into board games, so we played a lot of that, so that was kind of different from the usual.
It breaks my heart every time you tell me that detail.
Why?
because it's like, when I think of conventions, I think of, like, the best times of my life, right? I think
yeah.
Like, the crazy adventures, the long nights, the going with random people I don't know and having awesome, amazing times. And then it's like, but like, it's almost like hearing like, yeah. So it's like, oh, I went to the club on Friday night. What did you do? And it's like, yeah, I played board games with my bros.
Oh, well, come on, dude.
I know.
That ain't cool.
It's just as valid. It's just as valid. I know.
Because I still got to play. I still got to check out a lot of games I never played. Somebody just asked. I can't see the messages swung by, but I did not play Settlers of Catan. Because I own that game already, so we played a bunch of games that none of us owned, basically. So I love Settlers of Catan; that's a fun, really fun game. Didn't end up playing that. Just like a tons of random ones. We ended up playing Lanterns a lot, which I think was on tabletop or something. But anyways, met a ton of new people there; that was really cool. But then also, got to go to a panel with Matt Mercer. He was probably the big name that was there. He seemed like a pretty genuine dude. I actually, you know, pretty funny guy.
Is he the Bradley Cooper of voice acting?
You know what? I wouldn't say no. He was a pretty chill dude. He was great. He was hilarious. And then the rest of my time I spent there was in the fucking arcades at the bottom floor, right? So, like, the whole bottom floor was basically, there's the giant merch booth area, and then on either side is console gaming and then arcade gaming. And oh my god, dude, the arcade section just was like, there's a whole third of it that was just dedicated to Japanese rhythm games, which was awesome because it just took straight back to, like, Akihabara, like, you know, just like in the arcades, like, it was tons of machines blaring random Japanese at you, and it was kind of a surreal experience. It brought me back to a time and place, like, you know, it was awesome. So I kind of just hung out there. I was usually there from like midnight to 4 a.m. Just kind of playing random arcade games. Like Beach Dream was my jam because didn't have much of a line. U-Beat was awesome, and I played a bunch of Taiko drums. Have you guys ever seen like the Taiko game, like the big Japanese drum games? It's like Guitar Hero, but instead it's more like DK Bonkers, I guess. But
I've seen it in anime.
Oh my god, dude! That That game is so much fun. Holy shit. We need to go to MAGFest next year, and we're going to wait in line because it's the longest line. But we're going to play it because it's awesome. You can play fucking Mario theme or the Pokemon battle themes on taiko drums.
Are you implying that we are going to MAGFest next
year? Yeah, that's what I'm implying. I'm implying that. Yeah.
You want us to go with you to MAGFest next
year? Yeah, why not? It'll be fun.
You know what? Yeah.
Yeah! Oh, it was definitely different than the other cons, because I've only been to anime conventions, and so this wasn't total anime. Like, the merch was way more, like, well-rounded. Yeah, I guess that's the right word, whatever, but, like, you know, there was some anime stuff there, but it was definitely skewed towards games, you know? But, yeah, I mean, lots of cool people. It, definitely the oldest convention, like, the average age was the oldest at a convention I've been to. Definitely average con-goer was, like, 23, 24, you know? So it attracts a pretty older crowd, but it's cool. The rave was kind of disappointing. That was the one thing that I was like, this could have been better. Like, there was no giant rave Lord Pikachu on the stage. You know, I missed that. That's
Jesus wasn't there.
Jesus wasn't there. No, instead there were just a bunch of inflatable T-Rex, like people in T-Rex costumes raving with each other. That was pretty fun for a while, but it was just like four T-Rex dudes like breaking it down and. People were pretty amped about that.
I don't know, dude. Nothing will ever beat everyone, like, everyone having the dance circle and then, like, somehow becoming moderator of the dance circle and then shoving a Goku in there and everyone fucking giving him the power bomb or something. Like, nothing will ever beat that in my mind.
But, yeah. No. It was a good time, though. Yeah.
Yeah, no, dude. It does sound like fun. And that's the thing. I don't mean to, like, say shit and sound like I'm trying to fucking derail you. Like, no worries. I mean. It's just you know me. Cons are like bread and butter, man. But like, it sounds like you had a good time, and like, you know, it. I am genuinely curious, like, the differences between the anime conventions and the gaming conventions, because like, it feels like they would be two very different beasts.
Right, right. Well, so that's the thing, right? So I think what you have in your head is that, like, because like, you know, ColossalCon has a board game area, but it's just like, you know, like a handful of tables, right? Like, and then I bet in your head. I was just there with, like, the five other people that are there, you know, because no one goes to ColossalCon to play board games, you know? I wouldn't go to ColossalCon to play board games. But at MAGFest, there's a whole entire floor dedicated to it, right? So it is just tables upon tables upon tables of people playing games. People brought their own board games that they made for people to try out. And then people were just generally kind of, like, floating around from table to table, like, hanging out with people. It was pretty open and, you know, it was a lot of fun. Yeah, I don't know. Again, like I did not feel like I wasted my time at the board game table. But like, I think I would do things a little differently next year, though, now that I'm a little bit more comfortable. Probably check out the music scene there. Because the MAGFest is music and gaming, and I didn't really check out the music part of it too much. There's tons of chiptune artists there that were really talented and stuff, but I didn't end up checking those music panels out too much.
See, the music part would be what I'm like would mostly be into.
Right.
Like, I feel...
Well, that seems like I can't really speak too much to that, but I've heard that it was pretty cool. So, like, there's tons of music panels and stuff like that. There's a Steven Universe panel. There's a Steven Universe jam session panel. I was like, fuck, Mitch needs to be here.
Damn! Yeah. Damn it all!
Yeah, yeah, I know. Steven Universe fandom was repping strong there. Not a lot of merch, disappointingly, for Steven Universe, but there's plenty of people. There's plenty of gem costumes. There was an awesome Sardonyx, like, really good Sardonyx. Like, holy shit. I didn't grab a picture with her because I was dumb. And I'm in a rush, but wow, she like, that shout out to whatever, like, that was probably my favorite cosplay there. Very well done. Because multiple arms is hard to pull off.
Oh, sorry. I feel like this month was really, like, well, it's a big con month, because not only did you go to MAGFest, but, like, Strider went to OhioCon, and she sent me Snapchats throughout the entire con, but, like, something I wanted to say real quick about the Steven Universe thing was, like, man, that, talk about a fandom that cannot find, like, its proper place amongst, like, convention going. Because it sounds to me like, yeah, Steven Universe has a presence there, but it's not, like, this, like, the merch thing's a real thing, right?
Yeah.
But, like, every con I go to, there's tons of Steven Universe cosplayers, but there's, like, never, like, they never have, like, a sense of home there, where it's, like, it's very, like, I don't know. Fandoms are really weird about it, and, like, I remember people who are, like, anti-Steven Universe being very much, like, well, why are they here at this con? And it's, like,
anti-Steven Universe? Oh, no. Is Steven Universe starting to occupy the same kind of niche that My Little Pony is? Because with My Little Pony, the fandom, there's people that are very into the fandom, and there's people that are very against the fandom. You know what I mean? Like, is Steven Universe starting to fall into that, you think?
I feel like it's probably more like Homestuck.
I don't think it is.
Okay, good.
God, I hope not. Josh, yeah, you gonna say something, dude?
Huh? Oh, I was saying that it's probably, like, more the same neighborhood as, like, Homestuck. Where it's, like, you get a lot of people representing it at, like, cons, but at the same time, it's, like, they don't meld very well, I guess, with, like, I guess, like, an anime con.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say that it's not that they meld, but it is, like, a noticeable difference, where it's, like, Homestuck was the most noticeable, because there was a lot of people, especially in the early years, where, like, you had, like, that giant influx of cosplayers and such like that, where it was noticeable that there is a difference in the cosplays and the in jokes and everything like that. And it was a completely different, like, monster. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But like, I don't think Steven Universe is getting to that point. I think, like, it's just more like the people who are against it being at the cons are the just vocal minority.
I mean, I feel like they're, like, you know, purist type people.
We totally just derailed the MAGFest talk. I'm so sorry.
Oh, no worries. But that does strike me as weird, though. Just, I don't know. I don't know why you'd be against Steven Universe so much. It's weird to me. But I'm obviously super biased because we're obviously way into the show. But
yeah, we have a huge, like, tremendous bias.
Right. That's my problem, right? So go ahead, Josh.
Oh, I think a lot of it is just people like to be purists about things. Like, so, like, oh, Steven Universe, it's animation, but it's not anime.
I'm so tired of that conversation. It's like, yeah, I don't care. Yeah, I think the greatest thing.
Kinds of people who would matter too,
right?
Honestly, I don't really care too much.
I'm so happy that it took your lead, bitch. On, like, just, I'm not gonna say that I'm watching anime. I'm just watching whatever I watch. You know, like, I'll watch JoJo's, I'll watch Little Witch Academia, but I'll watch Steven Universe. Like,
you're a fan of animation,
right? Yes, exactly. Yes, yes. That was a way, that was, like, super, like, I don't know, liberating is a really weird word for something.
Myself a weeb, I don't actually tell people I'm an otaku, I tell people I like animation.
Yes, exactly, exactly. Yeah, I'll joke that I'm a weeb every day and night, but, you know, yeah. Anyways, MAGFest. So, transitioning into MAGFest, after I got home, I had a hankering to play some fucking shitty-ass Japanese rhythm games, right? I just couldn't do it. And then also, my friend was talking about DDR. Like, he was way into DDR. He just bought a foam pad, and apparently he's been dancing to some weeb trash, which is, like, and I'm just like, fuck, like, I want to play some fucking weeb trash anime rhythm games.
I just imagine you back at your home, fucking you're a little butterfly, just, like, fucking blasting hardcore, like...
Yeah.
God.
Oh, and then, you know, what happens, look, I go into the PSN, and what do I see? I see a brand new fucking Hatsune Miku Project Diva game, Project Diva Future Tone, free to fucking try it. I was like, well, the planets are aligning, maybe this is the time, and so I downloaded it, it comes with two free songs, and I really liked Weekender Girl, that's, like, it's really fucking good.
Oh,
yeah,
that is a solid song.
They knew what they were doing when they made that one free, right? And so I ended up buying the $30 pack for, like, 120 songs for Future Tone. And I'm playing fucking Project Diva now. I'm officially ascended to full weebdom, you know.
I don't know if we can save you from this.
I know. I don't know if I can save myself.
Josh, you're the one who's like, I don't know if we can save it. And I'm the one with chains dragging him further into hell.
Because, like, I Snapchatted Mitch a picture of the start screen, and I was like, here we go. And then his immediate question is like, oh, like, what's your favorite Vocaloid? And I'm like, there's more than one? But it's just like, oh, God, like, I don't... it's so scary.
You both.
Oh, my God. There's, like, so many good producers, and, like, I could talk about Vocaloid. Like, the thing... I could talk about Vocaloid, but I'm not 100% knowledgeable. You know who is? Channel artist Maddie Boo totally is 100% vocally trash. And
really? Okay. Like, I'll ask her.
Yeah, no, dude, if there's anyone that you should talk to about, like, good recommendations, it's her. Like, I can point you to, like, high-energy, high-octane good shit, because I feel like me and you would have that same taste.
Oh, that's that dank shit, dude, yeah.
Oh, my God. Oh, dude, I got to send you. You know what the best part is? They use Vocaloid songs sometimes in MMD for JoJo's music video.
Oh, God.
Crossing the streams, motherfucker. So, yeah, no, I'm going to drag you into this hell as much as I can. There's a lot of really good...
I'm like, just imagining, like, a JoJo's, like, fucking battle tendency Vocaloid music video.
There is a lot of those.
Oh, God.
There is a shit ton of those. Some of my favorite songs from Vocaloid, like Lovatory, stuff like that, is like a Joseph and Caesar MMD, and they're just dancing, and it's like, oh, it's so good. and it's not even like the thin models that they use sometimes. It's like they're like thick as fuck.
Oh my god.
It's so good. Vocaloid, like I'll send you the good high octane producers. There's a lot of really good ones out there. But another thing I really like about Vocaloid is like some producers are really into like rock, and dude, I've been riding the rock train. Like, fuck. Oh, so good. Rock and roll is so fucking good. But yeah, no, Vocaloid, though.
No
good
one can
shit,
defeat
good
the
shit.
Metal.
I'm just going through the song lists. I'm just trying to clear them on hard to get the expert ones, because apparently that's the thing to do. I suck at the game, so like I can only clear like hard on like four, like five stars or less, pretty much, is what I can do consistently. I mean, I just got the game on Tuesday, so I'm just trying to get my hands used to it. It's a lot of fun. It's scratching that itch in that, like, I've always wanted to get back into rhythm games, but, like, the only ones I've played are Western ones, so traditionally those will have, you know, the plastic instrument of some sort, so, like, Rock Band, Guitar Hero, DJ Hero, that kind of stuff. So this is the first time I've just been playing with a plain old controller, and it's good. It's good. I find the... Like the and I know the whole point of Vocaloid is to have like, you know, the dance, like it's, you know, it's the whole, like, you know, the visual aspect to it, but I find the actual music videos to be distracting, like a little bit, you know, like I don't ever actually watch them while I'm playing the rhythm game.
Diva Project, yeah, fucking lootly. That was, yeah. I did a stream of which got taken down because of fucking copyright.
No, I'm sure.
I did a stream for Diva Project, and the first thing I was gonna say was like, I've played the original Diva Project F, I think, for PS3. Uh-huh. I beat that one, and then I bought the second one because I was like, yo, I wanna start playing it now. I wanna start, you know, streaming it and shit. So the first thing I noticed was like I had spent a year away from it, and I forgot how distracting, especially with all like the very colorful, seemingly same color as the goddamn arrow.
Oh my god, dude, they fucking blend in, and it's just like, oh, Jesus!
And at that point, you might, like, it's like, oh, shit. Like, it's very clear that, like, there's some songs you just have to know, and they're expecting you to repeat the songs and get them down and everything like that. But, like, fuck, dude. It's good to hear that, like, you're... Because, like, rhythm games is one of those, like, genres that, like, I don't really see a lot of people, like, get really into, besides obviously the one other person that we know.
I mean, I know a few people who are like really into rhythm games. It's like Osu and all that crap.
Right, Osu. You can really fall down the rabbit hole. Well, that's the thing. Like, I showed up to MAGFest, and like there are these, like, you know, all of these rhythm games are Japanese, right? So in Japanese language and everything, like there are people that were just straight up walking up to like fucking Beatstream. And like Ubeat, and it's like you can't normally play those games here. You know, they're not in normal arcades, and people were just fucking acing them on the hardest level. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, dude, this is the advanced weeb, dude. Like, I'm being mean, like that. Like, they're really like, I wish I could be as good at those rhythm games, but it just goes to show
they're a different kind of existence.
Right. Like, you could really fall down the fucking rabbit hole with these kind of things.
Son of a bitch.
Yeah, dude. I'll keep you posted on how Vocaloid goes. Because, right now the songs definitely hit or miss for me. Like you said, you and I have similar tastes in that I like the upbeat energy ones. The ones that are extra EDM-y. But, the slow songs, they're kind of love songs.
Oh,
like, the Vocaloid voices just don't mesh well with that kind of style. For me, at least. Maybe I'll grow to like it, but...
I will say this much. Have you only been checking out the ones on the games themselves? Because,
correct. I haven't. I did. There was one day at work that I wanted to tried to listen to Vocaloid while coding, and that was pretty. But that's the thing. Like when I'm working, I don't really actively listen. It's just fades into background. It helps me focus.
Okay. Because I will say this much right now. Because. While I do, here's the thing. The ones that are on the games are like the top tier, like most known first couple year.
Got it. Songs. Okay.
There's a lot of new ones or ones that are like variants, like V-Flower, who have pretty interesting voices and stuff. And also a huge thing with Vocaloid seems to be how a producer will tune the voice is the make or break for a lot of people. Like there's a great song, Close to You. V-Flower does there's a producer that used V-Flower to make this song, and the way that it's tuned and the way the voice is tuned and everything, it's a really great solid cover, it's a solid song, but it just sounds so realistic. And I didn't know it was a fucking Vocaloid until someone had to point out that Mitchell V-Flower is another one of these voice synthesizers. And then there's a great acoustic cover, and it's all done in the tuning. So the one thing I did notice with the games is there's almost a universal way that they did the tuning for their voices.
Which makes sense because they want unity across them all. You know, you have your Hatsune Miku dancing on the screen. You want her to sound the same, you know, for each song, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Some songs, the voices are oh my god, what do you mean this is not a real person singing? Especially, and the worst part is in the deep, meaningful songs, if it's not tuned properly, it falls apart horribly.
Yeah.
I've noticed. So, yeah, but we'll come back to Vocaloid, next week. I'll send you some stuff and, we'll come back to it. And, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
well, that was my mega topic. Got that one out of the way.
All right, I'm gonna tag.
Thanks for bearing with me.
All right,
I'm tagging.
All right, you're in.
Okay. So I'm gonna talk about. I was going to talk about comics. I'm gonna push that back. Because comic talk can be a big topic, but I'm gonna push it back because I want to talk about the anime. Because you were like, Mitchell, I'm really just glad that I got more into animation, not anime. And I'm like, guess what I did, motherfucker. guess what I've been up to?
Getting into anime. In the other direction.
Yeah, no.
Oh yeah. Oh, well, it's good though because you said you were taking a break for a while, so I'm glad that you're back in it. You know what I mean? It's good.
So, there's a lot that happened in the last month, but the most important thing I need to point out was we started Yuri on Ice. What up? We got 6 episodes in. We did it for New Year's. If you were part of the New Year's stream, that was awesome. We finished Catherine, and then right afterwards we started a Rabbit Cast, and we watched 6 episodes of Yuri on Ice. That is a fan-fucking-tastic series. Holy shit. I can totally see where people are coming from. The writing is really interesting. It doesn't alienate you with its information for the sport, and it conveys everything really nicely. The music's really great. There's not really much else to say except, oh my god. I feel like I'm talking about Steven Universe right now, where it's there's so much praise, you know?
Yeah.
I guess maybe the one thing that I can't even say this one thing. I can't figure it out in my head. There's not enough. Maybe. Okay, here's the thing. I haven't finished it. We're rolling at episode 6, and I'm waiting for Strider to come back so that we can start watching it again. And we're probably going to rabbit cast that, and we're probably just going to, you know, have fun with it and stuff. But I'm excited to finish it, essentially. I'm figure eight that dick. It's really, really gay. But I love how they handle it. It's done in a very normalized way where it treats everything, that's the thing, because I remember talking to Maddie about it beforehand, and, like, I was like, hey, dude, you know, I've heard about the series, what's up? And essentially, we both have this really good, really solid appreciation for, like, normalized sexuality and attraction for in anime, and it was just really solid. And you know, that's an opinion I've heard not only from her, but like I've also heard from like all my other friends who've been really into that series. So I'm very excited to watch more. Essentially, is what that boils down to. And also, yes, I am aware, DM. I am aware that Yurio is 15 years old. I never said I wanted to fuck him. Okay, I need to say that. Because DM is under the impression that because a character is blonde, that I want to jump their bones immediately. That's not how that works. This was supposed to come off as a joke, and you two are not laughing or chuckling or anything. So this just sounds very real.
No. I understand you need to defend your character and all.
Yeah.
This got, like, oddly real. It's supposed to be a joke.
It always gets real at the best times.
Oh god. Anyways, the other anime I watched, actually,
one thing about Yuri on Ice, actually.
Oh yeah, sure, what's up, dude?
It's strange. It's like, I think I am not quite as hot on it as most people. I quite enjoyed it, but at the same time, it's like, I don't know if it like kept me super duper interested throughout the entire series.
Well, there's that...
I think it's a great series, but it's something where it just doesn't, like, tickle all my fancies, I guess. Something I noticed about, like, the other works by this director.
What's the other works, if you don't mind me asking? Do you know any at the top of your head?
Yeah, I've actually watched two other series by this director, and she doesn't direct all that much. She did one of the Lupin the Third anime, the one about Michiko... a woman named Mine Fujiko. And for those who don't know, Mine Fujiko is actually who Kojima based Eva's character on. And then she also did Michiko and Hachin, which is like an anime set in like this sort of parallel universe like Latin America, where, like, a absentee mother comes back and, like, reclaims her child to, like, go search for, like, her estranged husband. And they're all really cool and interesting series, but at the same time, it seems like they always seem to... they lose me, like, halfway through. And they're great, and they're, like, they've got so much texture and character, but it's, like, something about it, like, just doesn't hold me, I guess.
I was about to ask, like, could you think of, like, what it was that didn't, like, what didn't grip you to finish it?
I guess part of it is just, like, at a certain point with these series, a lot of it sort of they're always really, they want to do so much, or these series want to do so much. That, like, it seems like they can never deliver on the promise of, like, their first episodes, which are always great. It's like, they want to have this sort of, like, grand scope that, like, I see this promise and I go, oh, hell yes, I want all of this. And then it's like, somewhere along the line, they'll usually, like, stumble a little bit. With Yuri on Ice, I think it was just, I saw so many skate programs that I got a little bit tired of them, I guess, at a certain point.
I feel like that's, like, very specific, like, not very specific to the series, but, like, I feel like that's, like, if it's not your cup of tea, you're not going to get into it kind of thing. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
It's like, you know, I really enjoyed, like, and I think it's also part of the problem where it's, like, Yuri on Ice was so ambitious with its, like, scope for, like, they pretty much... like, half of the series is skate programs. And there's so much motion in them, and they have to animate all of that. And, of course, at a certain point, there's going to be, like, a breakdown in animation quality, and it makes me a bit sad that they couldn't deliver all the way through, even though it's, like, almost unrealistic to expect them to be able to.
That, yeah... Yeah. I mean, how do I word this? I feel like the thing in my mind that I'm comparing it to right now is like, it's like Free, right? I'm watching Free with the Goobers right now, and while I'm having a good time with it, when the minute they start swimming against each other, it's like, I don't know. I liked every other part of it except the swimming, which is like the whole point of the show. See,
it's because it's Kyoani. Right? Everything that's not like the main event is supposed to be enjoyable.
Like I feel like it's like that. But with Yuri though, the one thing that got me with Yuri was like how they explained everything and how like it's. I guess there's something that I enjoy in that. But like I said, it's one of those things where it's like I feel like if it's not your cup of tea, you're not gonna get into it. And there's nothing wrong with that because the show itself is still very solid, like just in general. But anyways, yeah. So. Last week I watched two other series. It was Fuka and Eldalive. I told you guys beforehand that these were two series that I was super excited for. Each one of these is a manga I was into a little bit ago. Fuka being a series I was into in 2014, I think. So look, I'm gonna level with you guys like right now. Both these series are kind of garbage.
Really?
When I say garbage, I mean, like, this isn't Yuri on Ice. I feel like I'm watching all this, like, really solid writing series and all these, like, really fun stuff. And then there's Fuka.
It ain't no Westworld.
Well, yeah, no, you know what it is? It's like everyone's watching, or I was watching Westworld, and then I was watching, like, Breaking Bad, and now I have to go home. Or not go home, but now that everyone else is gone, I decided to continue watching, like, Cheers. like or Frasier, like the other shows that I'm into.
Sure.
So a good way of putting it is this. I'll start with Fuka real quick, and it's only one episode out, so I won't go into spoilers or anything, but like I'll just say this. Well, there's three episodes right now. Fuka is a fantastic series if you're into, how do I word this? If you're into series that kind of take you on a roller coaster, go for Broke. It is admittedly kind of fan service-y at the very beginning, but over time that kind of declines a bit. I'm interested to see how the anime handles this. Because the thing about Fuka that I really enjoyed was not the fan service, it was how they talked about music, specifically rock and roll. Talking about bands and albums and all that stuff, and I really enjoyed that, and what happens with that is always really is like my favorite part of Fuka. And also I will say this much for anyone who has read the manga, first of all, it is available on Crunchyroll if you guys are interested in it. It is,
oh man, like, I think the like shill a, section
well no I'm just saying no, it's no. available on Crunchyroll if it is available on the Crunchyroll's manga app, if you guys have that, because that's how I read it.
Okay.
And I will say this much right now, the reason Fuka could have been a very, like, basic anime, and unfortunately, Gangmuro pointed out, of course I would be into Fuka, the main character has blue short hair. So, yeah, no, fuck this series.
Didn't I point that out, like, when you, like, first showed me that manga?
First of all, I didn't need you to double emphasize that, Josh, okay? I didn't need you.
Blue hair was the original thing.
It's the first B.
Yeah, it's the first B in there. Yeah, definitely.
It's like, at least since it's like top Aqua,
priority B.
From like, blue, fucking
it's a
Kingdom
blue
Hearts.
Hair. Blue hair, you don't need any of the other three Bs. You're good to go.
I hate you both so much. Oh, God! You motherfuckers. You fucking push this shit. God, okay, the point is, some of the stuff they talk about is something that I find really interesting. For example, the main character, this is episode one kind of talk, it's not too big spoilers, but he's really into Twitter. He's always on his phone, he's always on Twitter.
You know, apparently the Japanese are, like, really, really into Twitter.
You know what the funny thing is? I didn't believe it, and then I read the manga, and then I was like, is this a thing? And I had to look it up. Like, he's really into Twitter, and so, like, he meets a girl named Fuka who, who is the blue-haired girl, and who is disconnected from that, from the internet, from, or at least the social media aspect of it, and it's just really into CDs and that music and that kind of thing. I thought the manga was really sweet, and it does this really interesting thing, and that's when I got really into it. And if you read the manga, and you know what I'm talking about, then you'll be right where I'm at right now, which is, how the fuck are they going to handle that? Because right now, I don't know how I can see. I can't see it. And I'm really curious to see where that goes. So I'm going to be probably watching more Fuka throughout the time that we have here on the Velvet Room. Probably on more rabbits and stuff. And then that leads into Eldalive, the series that I've been revved for since like one of the early podcasts I talked about, where it's like, hey guys, guess what series I'm actually revved for, though? Fucking Eldalive. Because for those of you who don't know, Eldalive is a series created by Akira Amano, who did Katsuki Hitman Reborn. And back in 2011, I was super hardcore into Reborn. It was like one of my favorite mangas. And I am enjoying this. It reeks of Amano's work. Like it's very like light and fun, and it's really enjoyable to watch, honestly. You might not like it if you're into like goofy stuff. It's very goofy. That's the best way of putting it. Like it's not Gintama levels of goofy. Like Gintama is like Japanese Always Sunny in Philadelphia, right?
You're right.
I'm not talking about Always Sunny in Philadelphia. I'm just talking about like just goofy humor where it's like it's just very out there, very out of this world kind of stuff, and it's cute. It's a very cute series, and I'm very much looking forward to the next episode. So if any of you guys check it out, let me know, and we'll talk a little bit more about it, because I don't want
to... You know, I think I sat in on, like, a rabbit cast for, like, Eldalive and Fuka.
Yeah, but, like, there's it's weird, because both, like, Fuka's an easy series to talk about, because there's a lot, like, overarching story. Eldalive has a lot of, like, what-the-fuck kind of stuff in the first episode that, like, I can't talk about, because it's the first episode.
Hmm.
But yeah, so that, I guess that was my anime stuff, yeah? So, yeah.
Oh, boy.
Anime, guys.
I can talk about Conception
2. No. Yeah, go. Please go. I don't want to talk about Conception 2.
And I'll continue the weebery.
Do it.
Alright, so...
Do it!
Have either of you guys watched Little Witch Academia's new episode?
No, okay, not yet.
Here's the thing. I have not even started...
Yeah,
I fucking know that you haven't even watched like the OVA.
No, but okay, but the reason I say that is because guess what? Gang Mudo has also told me, what do you mean you haven't watched this yet?
No, I totally understand. You don't watch things that I recommend to you. And I've recommended this to you before.
Well, my problem is that I completely forgot, because when I heard that Netflix picked up Little Witch Academia, I was like, oh, fuck yeah, like, Netflix got it. And then the first episode came out, and then I realized that Netflix doesn't release its series episodically, or releases them at season. I was like, oh, no, Netflix got it. So, I'm not going to be able to stream those things, the episodes legally, until the end of the season, right? And so
I was about to say, Josh, are you asking us to go on pirate sites to access the series? Because
no.
I will not do that.
No, and that's not even saying like that I wouldn't, but like it's just that I just because it's not on Crunchyroll or Netflix, I like it, the level of convenience is already gone for me, and I'm like, oh crap, like now I have to put an effort to watch it. So
you see, my love for Trigger shows just compels me to do this.
Oh my god,
I know, I love
Trigger show.
What? Yeah, well,
of course
Little Witch Academia
show. Little Witch Academia is like the thing that launched Trigger.
Yeah, dude. Remember the Kickstarter for Little Witch Academia 2 for Trigger? Oh yeah. Dude.
Oh, I. Oh.
Like,
yeah,
Trigger,
dude.
Like, the first
two
titles that, like, made Trigger were fucking, like.
How did I avoid
Little Witch Academia and Kill la Kill.
Yeah.
And like, Inferno Cop, but that's a completely different thing.
Well, yeah, but Inferno Cop was amazing in and of itself, but.
Apparently, Inferno Cop was, like, made, like, for, like, each weekend, like, they spent, like, an hour on it.
That's amazing.
Like, they weren't allowed to actually spend any more time than that.
That's good.
That's pretty great.
I think that's probably why it's so good. Have you seen the first OVA? Mitch?
For no, no, Lunatic I haven't Academia? Actually. No.
What? Okay, no. That is on Netflix. You should watch that.
Watch it now.
Yeah,
now, but
there's two later. OVAs actually on Netflix. You
Eventually.
Can watch them. Yeah.
Watch now, the first one. It's like 30 minutes long, and it's great.
Yeah. So, but the anime series, it's restarting. Like, it's not a sequel, right? It's just a reboot. The reboot seems weird to call it, but whatever.
So
like,
the anime seems to just, like, the OVA seems to exist by themselves as something, like, sort of separate, and then
separate?
The anime series
okay.
sort of, like, starts at the very beginning with, like,
okay.
our main character, like, entering, like, the magic school. And
gotcha.
Becoming
it's the characters. Same characters, though, right?
You're a witch, Harry!
It's the same characters,
yeah,
though.
Pretty
yeah.
much all the same characters.
Okay,
from
okay.
the opening, it seems like they even have the characters from the second OVA in it.
Okay. Wow. All right. Sweet. I need to watch it then.
But it's totally something that, Mitch, if you're going to get into this series, now's a good a time as ever. Totally. Fun fact, the first OVA was actually funded through the Anime Mirai Awards, which was also the thing that funded the Death Billiards OVA.
Right.
So it's like the Anime Mirai stuff has like pretty much given us some of like the best anime to come out like in the last few years. That said, anybody, Andre, have you kept up with Konosuba at all?
I haven't, no. I'm halfway through the first season. I really enjoyed what I watched of it, but I haven't. I need to finish the first season before I go into the second one. Have you started it yet?
Second season, see, you know, it has the same problems as like Durara, like second season, I guess.
Oh, okay.
Where it feels like so there's this joke between like myself and Mitchell where it's like Durara, like the. They had their 26 episode anime, and then they had like two OVAs afterwards, and it felt like it's just like they used the leftover money from after they made the series proper to like make the OVAs. And then when season two came around, it's like, oh, the quality just continued from like the OVAs onwards. Like they just had like a wee bit of money like trailing along, and like the quality seems to keep on dropping. With Konosuba, pretty much the same feeling comes through where like the artwork looks a lot derpier than the first season.
Oh no.
And honestly, I don't mind. Konosuba was always a sort of derpy looking anime, and
yeah,
I think like, it sort of plays into it pretty well.
Alright. I mean, but it had the right amount of derp, you know? Like
I think more derp isn't going to harm the series.
I guess
it's strong enough that it can be pulled along by its like visual sight gags alone, I think.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah, that was like my quick little weeb corner tagging out back to you.
Back to me?
Yep.
To me?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, well, I guess I should talk about this now while I still can focus. So, did that our YouTube jokers watch the Nintendo Switch presentation that happened on Friday night?
Thursday night, I guess. Was too busy watching anime. Oh. Someone actually drew attention to it in the Rabbit Cast, and I was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna watch this anime and go home." Like it's like Mitchell, don't you want to watch the Nintendo stream? It's like I'm tired. I'm gonna go to sleep.
Okay. Well, I stayed up and watched it. Because I'm a Nintendo fanboy. I guess not enough people. I guess no one, whatever, like, I'm, like, number one Nintendo fanboy, like, I got a Wii U, like, you know, the year it came out, I fucking have way too many fucking amiibos sitting in my fucking cabinet, so I've been really excited about the Switch, right, because coming off of their announcement video, I was actually pretty, excited about it, in that, like, I think it had potential to have mainstream success, you know, like, this seems like the perfect kind of thing for Nintendo to follow up from the Wii U with, you know? But then after that presentation, dude, fuck, man, like, I don't know, like, I'm worried, you know, like, I pre-ordered mine, from the top, I pre-ordered mine, like, I have one pre-ordered, it's coming, I'm getting it, but, I don't know, there's so many little details about the thing that make me just shake my head, you know, like, it's just like, well, I guess I should just start listing off, so first off, the price is at $300, which is fine. But the problem is that's competing with PS4 and the Xbox One, which go for the same rate or even lower now, you know? So, yeah, exactly. Like, you could buy a PS4 for $300 right now, and honestly, I would say that that's a way safer investment. But anyways, at the end of the day, I think it's fine. I think it's an okay price point, but still. The main thing is that, like, there's going to be a paid online service now, so, and they didn't really detail, like, too much about it, like, so basically it's going to be like PlayStation Plus and Xbox One, or Xbox Live, where you have to pay a yearly subscription to play online multiplayer, which is, like, fine, I guess, but Nintendo
like,
doesn't...
Nintendo's, like, track record with this stuff.
Exactly, dude. Like, it's just not good. Like, and so to be fair, it's gonna be free until they think they said fall. I don't know. Maybe they said a specific month, but like, it's gonna be free through the summer, and then in the fall is when we'll have to start paying for it. So at least we'll have a few months to know, like, okay, yeah, this is shitty. It's not worth paying for. Or like, oh, hey, they turned it around and it's really good. But yeah, I don't know. It just seems bizarre. And then they have, like, their thing is that you get a free game every month, like a SNES or a Super, like a NES or a Super NES game, but you only get to play it for that month, and then after that month is up, you have to go buy it if you want to play it again, which is, like, it's so shitty compared to PS Plus and Games of Gold, because, like, Games of Gold and PS Plus, at least you get to keep those games as long as you stay subscribed, right? But with the Nintendo subscription, you're only going to get to play it for that month, and that's it. And it's gone. Seems like a pretty, I don't know, pretty big downer.
I would assume, though, maybe this is like, maybe this is kind of just me being optimistic, that, like, because they would make it so that it's not playable after the month, like, it's going to be bigger titles. The one problem I have with the PlayStation Plus system is that, like, a lot of those games that they give out for free
are pretty, like, small. Like indie
are
games.
Small or shit games.
Yeah. They haven't been. They used to be stronger, like back in the PS3 days. Like apparently like when PS Plus first started, it used to be pretty good AAA games. But now it's not. Now the slim pickings ish. But I'm pretty sure they confirmed that it's going to be a NES or a Super NES virtual console game is what they're giving you. So one of those.
Oh.
Not. It's not. They're not. Yeah. Right. Like, come on, really?
I was gonna say, like, God. You know what they need to do? They need to make Pokken 2.
Oh, Pokken 2. Okay. Yeah, no, that's what gets you a Switch in your hands?
Okay, here's what will get me a Switch in my hands. Final Fantasy 14 that I can just lay in bed and just play.
Interesting. Wow, that's okay. All right.
The give up machine, to take a term from other channels and stuff. The give up machine where I can just crawl in bed and just grind in 14. No, what will get me a Switch is essentially anything that I think will be fun for the channel, honestly. So
sure.
On a completely realistic, yes, I will probably get one because the channel and Fire Emblem Warriors and
Shinigami. Oh my god, Fire Emblem Warriors. Somebody commented, the fucking Fire Emblem Warriors.
Oh my god, yeah. No,
oh,
so, like,
man.
I am a sucker for Warriors games. So,
right.
Like,
I'm
excited for that. Also, speaking of which, on a completely different side note, guess what comes out, like, I think, like, either this week or is already out.
What?
I need to just make sure I'm getting my numbers right here. Fate Extellia.
Oh! That's out.
It's out?
This week? Soon, you mean? Like, I don't know. You know, but
it comes out on Tuesday. Okay. It comes out on Tuesday.
Okay.
Fate Extella, the fucking Warriors game for the Fate series. And the only reason I'm excited about it is because I get to play Gilgamesh.
And also
Iskander.
Right. Oh, man, it looks so hype. Anyways.
So I'll
the only
I'll
ones you
next
actually
week
care
about.
That.
Everyone else is cool. Saber's amazing.
Oh man.
Hey man.
Is it
don't shit on
blonde?
I love Saber.
That was not sarcasm.
Oh, okay, good.
No.
I'm a Dark Knight in Final Fantasy, and I'm trying to get to the point where I can have a Saber-esque outfit.
Oh, nice.
But like I said, the Switch, like, if I didn't run the channel, I would say the things that would have to get me on the Switch is, a couple years ago I would have said fighting games, but to be honest with you, I don't...
Right? Like, are you drawing a blank? I mean, like, for me, it's easy. Like, I already got one because I love Nintendo games, so I'm going to get those no matter what. But the Wii U has made it very clear that people like me are not enough to sustain Nintendo, because people like me all bought Wii U's, but that wasn't enough people.
Oh, God. Okay, you know what? You know what will get me in? Here's the thing. Certain consoles had, like, single titles that got me in, right?
Sure.
Like, PS4... JoJo's Eyes of Heaven. But like, if they had some title, like if you told me that Katakiyo Hitman Reborn Fighting Climax was going to be on
the new
Switch,
the new
like,
Shin Megami
oh,
Tensei
shit.
is not enough.
Not enough for me.
All
it's
right.
Not enough.
Yeah.
Okay, I prefer the Persona aesthetic than to the like to the mainstream ones. The problem is I'm drawing a blank. I don't know what I would be passionate about enough to have on the Switch.
Right.
Because I'm not into fighting. I'm not as into fighting games as I was anymore. Like
and,
I feel
and
bad
also
because...
honestly, dude, even if you were like. I don't feel like the Switch is the best spot for play fighting games. Like, with the fucking controller, like, you'd just be better off playing on a PS4 or a PC, I feel like. You know?
God, it's sore. It's been very real. I had that realization of, like, wow, I'm getting better with my instruments. Why is that? Oh, I stopped playing fighting games. I'm taking all the time that I would normally be using to learn combos to learn chords.
Nice. Well, there you go.
Yeah, I feel like, but like, it's gonna become real when I go to a con and I have to go to the fight room and like, I have to like fight someone.
You just whip
and,
out
like,
your
Yuke. All
your
of it's gone. All my Relius is. I'm trading my Blaze Blue knowledge for.
Oh, God.
For music. So, oh, God. Anyways.
Overriding
Switch,
that memory.
Josh, is there any title that would make you purchase a Switch?
I actually don't think
so. Wait, there is one. Kill a Kill Platinum game.
Oh, shit. What the fuck?
It.
Why wouldn't... Platinum,
oh, yeah,
come on, that's
a
slam dunk.
Game.
Oh my God, have we talked about this before? That's
not on the cast, we haven't talked about it on the cast.
Oh man, that's such a perfect combo. Kill a Kill game with made by Platinum? Fuck, dude, like why... That's money on the table. Oh my God. Anyway, sorry. I'm just gonna be fantasizing about that. What game do you want, Josh? I'm fantasizing about that right now.
Well, honestly, it's like I don't know if there's any game that would make me want to buy like a Nintendo Switch, mostly because I haven't been interested in like Nintendo products since like the GameCube, I guess.
Yeah.
Anthony Hopkins Simulator.
Anthony Hopkins Simulator. It's just fucking Westworld.
Yeah, that's it.
Westworld Tycoon.
Westworld Tycoon. Yeah, that's what Josh gets. That's
interesting.
The game.
I don't know. Like I want this thing to do well, but there's so everything in the details makes it sound so much more cumbersome than it needs to be. You know, like,
I mean, hopefully, like you know, the old school management style of Nintendo won't get in the way of like them taking steps forward.
Honestly, that's what it feels like. Though it's just. You know, the accessories are super expensive. A pro controller is $70. A pair of Joy-Cons are $80, or $50 separately.
Oh, Jesus
Christ! Yeah,
dude. How the heck do they expect people to, like, use this as, like, a social thing?
Right? Like, what? Like, come on! And
okay, hang on. Okay, to be fair, it seems like this is the direction they're going with this. It seems like what they're trying to do is they're trying to get rid of, like, future DS titles and stuff like that. There's the all-inclusive console, so they have to cut the cost somewhere.
But so that's the thing. Like, they could have gone they could have gone two directions with this conference, and they could have done it where it's a portable system that you can dock into your TV, or that it's a console that you can take on the go. And they're definitely leaning into the latter part, where it's like this is the Wii U that you can take with you, not the 3DS that you can shoot up to the TV. You know what I mean? Like just everything that they showed, those were console games. You know, they didn't feel like portable games. You know, I feel like they're playing the wait and see. This is also obviously just speculation. I don't know anything internally about Nintendo, but it feels like they're playing the wait and see game with the Switch. In that, like, or I should say the 3DS, and that if the Switch does well, then they'll phase the 3DS out, and then that the Switch will just be the new 3DS and the new Wii U, right? But if it doesn't do so well, then they guess they can continue on with, well, they have a choice. They can either continue on with their portable line or go all smartphone and just develop console games for the other consoles, you know? I don't know. I want this thing to succeed because I think Nintendo being on its own and having its own console with its own environment is good for video games, I think. But this, I just don't think they can afford another generation like they'd had with the Wii U, you know? And it's just everything around the Switch, you know? The idea itself is so good. Like, I love the idea, but everything around the execution of it just seems fumbled, you know? I haven't canceled my pre-order yet, but, like, I was heavily considering it, you know? And that's how, like, bummed out I am about it.
It's like,
fuck, man.
I
want to be excited.
I don't necessarily think myself as, like, somebody who particularly likes Nintendo, but at the same time, I think their existence is very important to, like, the game industry being healthy.
Yeah. Yeah. I hope it goes
well. No matter how uninterested I am in the Switch, I really do hope that Nintendo does well.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, who knows? The new Breath of the Wild, the new Zelda looks amazing. We've been waiting for that game for literally years, and that's like the one thing that I'm hanging on to my Switch pre-order for, because, hey, maybe it'll run better on the Switch or something, but that's the only game. So what is it? Day one, you get Zelda, you get 1-2 Switch, which is a collection of party games that you apparently, they're all audio-based, apparently. Like, you don't even look at the screen. That's what people have been telling me, which is like, what? But okay. And then like a Bomberman, like a Bomberman game, which is like, all right, whatever. I'm not into Bomberman, so Zelda it is.
Oh, you're not into the illustrious origins of Bomberman?
Yeah, no, can't say that I am, you know. And it's made by Konami, right? So like, at this point, does Konami even make video games anymore? I mean, come on. But yeah, whatever.
I mean, you know what they should do? They should give all their IPs to
I guess. John.
They should give all their IPs to Platinum and see what they do.
Yeah, so they can get canceled.
God, do not talk to me about that fucking garbage that Platinum always has to go through.
Yeah, I mean, but real talk, okay, so Scalebound, right? You were never going to play that game either way, Mitch, because it's on the Xbox One.
Oh, I know, but well, I would have been happy.
Oh, no, that's not true. It would have come to Windows 10, and you have a gaming-capable PC now, so you could have played it. But
damn it! No, I was gonna say the thing that would have brought it home, like in my mind, is like, you know what though, I would have been happy that Platinum released another game.
Right. Well, hey,
I even if I can't play it, I would have been like, you know what,
dude,
though,
we don't
somewhere
to,
out there.
There's a Platinum
having
game.
The Platinum experience. Yeah.
Well, hey, did you download the Nier Automata demo?
I have not touched PS4 in some time.
You should probably do that for the channel.
You should do that. So you should it's a good, it'll be a good channel video because A, it's a Platinum experience bundled into like, you know, an hour of gameplay. B, it's fucking Platinum, dude. It's so good. It's I'm really excited for Nier Automata now. I haven't played the first one. I don't think a lot of people have, but this seems pretty strong. I'm pretty pumped about it. Check it out. It's free. It's good.
Good.
So yeah, Switch, I don't know. I got my pre-order going. I'm cautious. I don't even want to call myself optimistic. I'm concerned, and I hope they do. I hope Nintendo does well, and I hope that my reservations are unfounded. But right now, it seems like they're fumbling the ball a little bit. So I don't know. We'll see.
Well, you know what's going to happen. The biggest thing that I notice that people are kind of scared of right now is the release numbers. Like, they're worried that like certain stores are only going to have like 14.
Oh,
of these
yeah.
Ones.
Well, that's the thing. So, Nintendo always has a problem with supply. I wouldn't really be too worried about that because right now there's like almost zero reason to get a Switch day one unless you don't have a Wii U and you really want to play Zelda, right? But that's like the only reason to play to
I
get
mean,
the Switch.
That could very well lead to like huge lines.
Yeah, that's true. That's
like,
true.
Zelda
but
could
it,
be the killer app for a lot of people.
Well, it absolutely is, but if it wasn't also coming to the Wii U, and I'm not trying to say that it shouldn't come to the Wii U, because that'd be so fucked up if they didn't bring it to the Wii U after they promised it, you know? But if it was a Switch exclusive, then I would be more confident in it doing well, because goddamn, that's a killer app.
You know what? Okay, I just realized what the killer app for me would be. I'm sorry. I just... I just realized immediately. If they remake Bravely Default,
oh, okay.
For the Switch, like if it's just like a dub,
you
HD...
should. Oh, this is not what you want. But what is it called? Like Project Oct? Like, hold on, Square Enix. Sorry, keep talking. I need to look it up.
Yeah, no, it's Bravely Default was the thing that like solidified my sale on the 3DS, and it's like the one thing I have not played. The second one. And I want to play it so fucking bad.
Okay, here it
it's
is.
Such a good game.
Yeah, it is really good. You should check out. This is good. It's very far off, but Square Enix announced an RPG for the Nintendo Switch. It's called Project Octopath Traveler. Sorry, Project Octopath Traveler. Yeah, very short, like you know, trailer. But like it, that seems to be like their next iteration on old school JRPG. The art style looks really interesting to me. It's way far off.
Oh, it's sprites, huh?
Yeah, exactly. It's way far off. But the same guys who made Bravely Default are making it. So.
Okay, because like the thing that got me on Bravely was the battle system was really fun, but also like the arts. I really like the chibi work for that. Like it just looked great, honestly.
Yeah.
I feel like this looks like it'll have like a similar like play style, which will be great.
Yeah.
But I'll have to check it out. Also, for those of you who do not know, if I could right now, I would be playing Bravely Default. It is such a good game. Oh
yeah.
My god. It is like I know that like okay, not to get into it, but like one of the biggest criticisms about that game is that it gets a little repetitive near the end, but like if you've ever played a previous Final Fantasy, like some of the original Final Fantasies, especially the first one, then it like makes sense. Like it's almost like really tongue in cheek in that respect, or something like that. Good way of putting it, like that. So yeah. Anyways, yeah. Let's yeah. Sora, yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Switch. Good. I don't know. The other game plan. Well, make it break it is how it does in the holiday season, right? Because that's after. You have that's when Nintendo has Mario, you have Mario Kart, you have Splatoon 2, you have Zelda, you have all of your big franchise hitters, not all of them obviously, but like a good lineup ready to go to sell, like hey, here's the Nintendo Switch, here's all the Nintendo games you can buy on it right now. That'll happen by holiday, that where everyone's buying new consoles. So
makes me wonder when the new Smash Bros will come out.
I was honestly shocked to not see a Smash Brothers announcement there, in that it's so like they should just make a Melee or HD port, or they should do what they're doing with Mario Kart and just report Smash Brothers for Wii U with, like, you know, one deals, like, maybe, like, all the 3DS stages and like, a new character or something. Like,
Krom.
That would be so easy.
Krom's in there, yeah.
Yeah, Krom. Put Krom in there. Yeah. Make it Fire. No, that's Fire Emblem Warriors, actually. Is the shit. Fire Emblem Warriors is actually just a port for Smash Brothers for Wii U, but they just took out the rest of the non-Fire Emblem roster, so, you know, it's just all Fire Emblem fighters now.
Yeah, no, but now me and you can team up online, though, and play Lucina, because neither of us want to play anyone else.
Right.
No, okay, but here's the thing. I really... Okay, this has nothing to do with my personal... feelings on Smash. I really hope they don't make another one. I don't think the creator of that game wants to make another
Sakurai?
Smash.
Yeah, you know what? If they make another Smash, this is going to sound rude, but I hope Sakurai is not involved with it, or at least has a passing involvement, because I think his attitude is not very healthy to Smash anymore. I don't, like...
I mean, he never liked how Melee turned out.
Yeah, which is, like, the best one... yeah. Like, Sakurai's a seriously talented dude, and I'm super happy that he's done, you know, all that he's done so far for the Smash series. I hope he moves on to something else, and I want to play his other games that aren't Smash, you know? Because he has a really creative mind. I loved Kid Icarus Uprising. That was great. But Smash, like, he just has this loathes, like, it just feels like he hates anytime somebody takes his game and makes it competitive, you know? And I don't feel like that's a problem. Like, and I get, like, his main... You know, I feel like Smash should always be a party game first, but that doesn't mean it also can't be a competitive game. You know, it's just...
absolutely.
It should actually be accessible, but...
Like, the really competitive scene for Smash doesn't really exist as much in Japan.
No, it doesn't.
It's primarily in the U.S. that it's competitive.
It's primarily in Southern California. Yeah.
It's one of the few, like, games where, like, the best players are not in Japan.
Right. And I understand, like, you know, Sakurai probably, he doesn't, he shouldn't have to pay attention to that stuff. That's not what I'm saying, but, like, he's also, like, he's made balance changes to the game, gameplay changes, to make it less competitive, you know, by design. And I feel like there's an opportunity that's seriously being wasted with the Smash franchise. And you know what, yeah, if Sakurai's creatively tapped out, don't make the man do another one. But I absolutely want them to keep making Smash games, you know, it's just so good. I don't want them to not ever make a Smash game ever again.
Minimum I would one want them to double down on the party game thing. Like, more items.
Hey, put in more items. I love having items as long as you can turn them off, you know? Like, I love having items in there. They're great. But
yeah, no. See, that's the thing. I would never... I don't think I could play Smash without items. Smash without items... I understand the appeal, but Smash is items to me. Like, that's what makes it, like, different from other fighting games, is, like, the random craziness of a stage and the situation you're put in. Like, that's what makes Smash fun.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know that's kind of a weird opinion, but, like, that's
no,
mine.
It's not a weird opinion. It's fine. Everyone plays Smash differently. Well, that's the greatest,
just,
that's the greatest
just
thing.
Let
Smash
me
is
hide
such
in
a flexible
corner
fucking
with Samus.
Game. Ugh. You can just do whatever you want. Like, I don't know. Whatever. There needs to be another Smash Brothers. I don't think there needs to be more than one per system, for sure. I think I like that Nintendo's shown restraint, and that they don't, you know, make, like, you know, Super Smash Brothers, you know, Wii U, like, you know, Rev 2, Ayo! But, you know,
people would get really bored of it really fast if it were, like,
right.
A yearly thing.
Right, right. Like, if it came out, like, every year, and they charge you $60 for, like, you know, just for, like, two new characters.
Super Smash Brothers 1.
Super Smash Brothers Chrono Phantasma. Super Smash Brothers Revelator. It just would get really old really fast.
Super Smash Brothers FES.
Yeah. Super Smash Brothers Golden. Anyways.
Oh, God.
And I realize I just asked for a port from the Wii U to the Switch, but I feel like that's a good idea just because the Wii U totally undersold. And I feel like people would totally, if you just had a game with the name Smash Brothers on it with minimum effort, I feel like you could get the Switch in people's hands, you know?
Well, I feel like it's a port that makes sense, especially because, like you said, it's the underwhelming amount that the Wii U did. Like, I mean, yeah, sure, it was available on the 3DS as well, but, like, you know, have a console that you know people are going to be invested in.
Yeah.
And just port the game there. And also that buys time to figure out exactly how to handle the Sakurai issue.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, anyways, yeah. So
yep.
Switch, that's...
Anyways, yeah. Sorry. I've lingered on the Switch long enough. Sorry. Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. Rock and roll, dude.
Yeah. Rock and roll.
Wait, whose turn is it? I just realized...
It's yours.
Is it?
Oh. Oh, God. Is it my turn?
Yeah.
Oh, no. I have to pick between two subjects I don't want to talk about. All right.
I mean, you could think of a new subject off the top of your head.
No. It's fine. Passengers. Let's talk about movies. So over the last month, I watched two different movies that it's not going to obviously be included with, you know, the talk we're going to have later about another movie we all saw. But I'm going to talk about the Chris Pratt sci-fi thriller Passengers, and also the movie Why Him, starring Walter White and Harry Osborn. So I'm going to start this off with Passengers. Now, the reason I don't want to talk about this, and it's not because the movie wasn't good. Here's the thing with Passengers. Stars Chris Pratt. Stars Star-Lord. I can't not see this guy as Star-Lord. I have an incredible bias towards him as an actor. He just seems like a really cool guy. I just like his performances. Just seems like a pretty chill, you know, pretty chill guy. He was opposite of Jennifer Lawrence, who actually is a pretty good actress, all things considered. I'm not a big fan of hers, but, like, you know, everything worked out fine. The movie, for the most part, plays off... By the way, did anyone else see this movie?
Nope, sorry.
Nope.
Okay, no, it's fine. I'll just give a real quick review then. Here's the thing. 80% of this movie is good. 4/5 of this movie is a fantastic, cute kind of short story almost.
Yeah, that's what it feels like a short story. I don't know, that, like, I would have read in high school. I don't know. I feel whatever. Anyway, sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. So that's it, right? So what happens is Chris Pratt's on a fucking starship that is traveling across the universe to a new planet, and it's going to take 112 years or something to get there. And his pod opens up early, and there's no way to put him back in the sleep, right? So he spends a whole year by himself, like, goofing off and shit. And eventually he begins, it gets really, really sad. Really, really sad. And this is some of the strongest parts of the movie, is watching him try to cope with it and then coming to the realization that he's going to spend his entire life by himself. And so eventually he gets to the point where, like, he's like, you know what? I hit the lowest of the low. I hit the lowest of the low. I feel like I need at least someone else to come with me here. And it's a great scene, I should say, throughout this part, because it's him struggling with whether or not he wants to wake someone else up and essentially imprison them on the ship with him kind of situation. And it's really interesting to see him go through it all. Like, it seems like there was a lot, like, of thought and direction and everything that was put into these scenes, because honestly, you feel for the guy. Like, it's good to feel something for your characters, you know? Movies sometimes don't achieve that, which I'll get to in a second.
Cough, cough. Rogue One, cough.
Yeah. So then he eventually awakens Jennifer Lawrence, and the two of them, it's a pretty cute, you know, interaction, stuff like that. It works well. And then eventually the truth was revealed that, hey, Chris Pratt, you were the one who woke Jennifer Lawrence up. And the reaction and everything at that point feels really good. These two actors who are super strong. By the way, some of the only actors in the film. There's a couple other people here and there, but like these two are the main focal point. There's no real other interaction besides these two, and like one other character or one or two other characters that may or may not show up. Who knows? you have this really interesting piece, and that is what I loved. I loved watching these two interact with each other, kind of go for the tropey fall in love kind of bullshit, but like it was done in such an interesting scenario and in such an interesting way that I thought was really cool. And then it gets to a point where it wrote itself into a corner and it didn't know how to end the movie or what to do at a certain point. And so it was like, fuck, how do we handle this situation? So then the movie turns into, so what, this odd, bittersweet, romantic, almost like weird, it almost feels like a case study sometimes, between these two, watching the interactions between these two humans becomes something like a sci-fi thriller, and it ruins the movie, and I thought the rest of the movie was garbage after that.
So yeah, that's the thing, like the trailers made it look like it was like trying to be like a romance movie and a sci-fi thriller at the same time. It's like, can we just kind of pick one? Like
four-fifths of this movie is a fantastic movie, and then the rest becomes like garbage.
Okay.
And I only say it, and here's the thing, if you like the rest of the movie, I totally 100% understand where you're coming from, but I feel like it was a real cheap way and to dampen the blow that some of the emotional blows that like happened. It felt very much like the movie could have had a really unique twist or a really unique take, and it didn't go for it, and it feels like...
You know what, like, I sort of suspect? I sort of suspect, like, studio meddling.
Actually, that's the thing, right? I was thinking about that, too, where there's something that happens that's very... I'm trying to be vague as possible here. And, like, it feels like something happened, and they had to write in some stuff that happens and some garbage that happens because, like, it wouldn't, like, they wouldn't be able to get to this problem otherwise. So I it could have been really interesting, and I feel like as just a unique film that would have been fun to watch, but
I mean, it sounds like it's fucking, like, really interesting, actually.
Yeah.
It's like, it doesn't feel like any film, like, I've really heard really advertised for a really long time, I guess. Like, something where the scope is just really small.
Mm.
With, like, a decent budget behind it. Which, you don't get that too much, just because everybody's either, like, really all-in, like, blockbuster, it has to be for everybody, literally everybody, or it's, like, some, like, sort of crappy rom-com or comedy.
Mm.
Yeah, this felt like they ruined the movie. Like, there's something off, but, yeah, that's Passengers. I would say this, if you see it on Netflix or, like, a future, like, streaming date, totally at least check out the first couple bits, because there's...
Oh, yeah, it sounds really interesting. I mean, it'd probably have been more interesting if they never, like, revealed, like, that Chris Pratt, like, unfroze her.
Well, yeah, I was actually, as I was explaining, I'm like, should I reveal that? And it's like, yeah, I have to, because that's a big chunk of it. Like, the audience knows. The audience is in on it, and it's I think it's actually revealed in a trailer or something, but, like, yeah. Go check out at least, because Pratt delivers so hardcore, and so does, and Jennifer Lawrence, mediocre human being, great actress.
Wow.
As far as I can tell, her reputation doesn't necessarily seem all that high and mighty. So, but yeah. That was Passengers, and then Why Him was another film I saw, which, if you not know about this movie, whoo! Why Him, essentially, Bryan Cranston, Walter White, has a daughter who's dating a Harry Osborn, whose name escapes me right now, James Franco! the movie is... I was not going to talk about this movie, and then I realized I probably should, because this is a great example of I watched a movie and I had no idea who this was made for. Here's the thing, right? Sometimes you go into a movie and you know exactly who this was made for. Like, it's a kid's film, or I should say a family film. This was clearly made, you know, XXX is clearly made for the people who like those types of movies, you know, Fast and Furious, rom-coms, that sort of thing. I do not know who was made for, because it is so weird. It's such a weird film. There are moments, it's a holiday film too, which is another weird thing. Like, it seems kind of off to have, so there's a lot of moments in the movie where it's like they're having, like, one, the editing is just, don't get me started. There is comedic timing sometimes is emphasized, especially in holiday movies, with music, right? And, like, there is absolutely no emphasis on the music whatsoever. And it's really weird. It's really weird. If you've ever seen a comedy, turn off the music in a comedy and see how you react to things.
Mm.
Like, it's bad. And some of those jokes, it's weird, because some of those jokes kind of remind me of, like something like my grandfather would watch or something like that. And it's like, oh, haha, my grandpa would think this is funny. And then some jokes are, like, about bukkake and, like, other things of that nature. So I'm like, who is this for?
Very, very totally dissonant.
Someone out there really enjoyed that movie, and it was exactly for them, right? So somewhere out there, there's someone who watched that movie and was like, this is
like
for
just
me.
One
this
person.
Is hilarious. I mean, you know, comedy is pretty subjective, so.
It feels very weird, and there's some jokes that just don't land, and it's too awkward, or, like, they don't push the joke too far, you know what I mean? It's like you're heating up water to make some tea, right? But you don't get the water hot enough, so when you go to make the tea, it's like this lukewarm, gross garbage. Like, that's what I feel like Why Him is. It's still tea. The bag and the leaves still are in
it's
there.
It's technically,
and I guess I could
steeping.
I could shake the bag around and and try to get an extra flavor. I could crush the leaves with like a fork or spoon or something and try to get more of that comedy out. But it's not there. And it's kind of disappointing because, admittedly, I do like Franco and Cranston. So I feel like a lot of it just boils down to editing. Editing was the big killer for this one, I feel. So, and it's weird for me to say that, but like some movies are just like that. In fact, we've talked a bit about that a couple times, Josh and I. So, yeah. Yeah, so that was my movie topics, and that's not even going into, by the way, just for some context, everyone, we are an hour and a half into this cast.
Oh, man.
Just, I need to say that because we also still have general topics.
Oh, shit. Talk about. I completely forgot about the general topics. Fuck. Oh, okay. Man.
So, yeah, I know I just went into Passengers and stuff like that, and why him, and technically I got an extra turn. But we do have a huge chunk of the cast left.
Oh, boy.
So,
I mean, if we do need to move on, we can move on.
I feel like we should at least talk about one more movie. Let's talk about Rogue One.
Oh, boy.
This is general topics already. Oh, man.
Yeah, I'm sorry, guys. It's just, oh, my God. Okay, let's talk Rogue One.
Yeah, man.
All right.
Okay, so I'm gonna start this off and just say real quick. This was a weird movie.
A weird movie? Yeah?
Okay. It's a weird movie because the fanboy in me loves this movie. Uh-huh. The Star Wars fanboy who was alive in middle school, who watched and marathoned all the Star Wars movies and saw and you know, wanted this so badly. Wants to like this, like is just in love with this movie and loves Jin and Cassian and all the cool characters and everything. But the person who I grew up to be cannot help but see some flaws in the film.
Uh-huh.
It has the opposite problem of why him, where we all know exactly who Rogue One is made for.
Yep.
Yeah. So who wants to say it out loud? Who was this movie made for?
Fucking Star Wars nerds, dude. I don't know. It's made yeah. for a lot of people, honestly. It's made for broad appeal, but I don't know.
I mean, I don't necessarily think that it has, like, the broad appeal of, like, the mainline Star Wars franchise.
Not quite, dude, but honestly, like, I would put this in similar tier.
I don't think that this would make a good family film, for example.
No.
Well, this is a war movie, guys.
Yeah,
this
it was a war movie. It was a nerdy war movie, though. But, like, that, I mean, come on. Like, Star Wars is the only reason, not, I shouldn't say the only reason, but, like, the main reason this is made was to make money on the off years. You know what I mean? Like, this is the perfect off year movie in that, like, you're getting people still, you just want people still interested in Star Wars every year. You know, keep the interest in the brand strong. And, like, yeah, it might not have the general mass appeal of, like, a main Star Wars episode, but there's still going to be lots of people. I mean, obviously, like, the movie did gangbusters, right? It's putting butts in seats, you know? That's a pretty broad appeal. I don't know.
I mean,
but, yeah, definitely not a kid's movie.
Because it's a Star Wars movie, just everyone's going to watch it anyways,
right,
no matter
right.
who it's made for.
Right. I
guess
so.
The title itself is enough to make everybody go, oh, my God. I had to, like, drop everything I'm doing and just watch this thing.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. Well, so what? All right. So what did you think, Josh? What did you like it?
It's something where I really liked it up to a certain point, and then at around the point where they shot off the Death Star for the first time, I went, oh no. I sort of had that sort of gut feeling where it's like, oh man. Why don't you get on the ship with them, old revolutionary leader who I don't know the name of? You totally don't have to watch this thing happen and, like, stay there. Fuck. And then I realized I probably wasn't going to enjoy, like, the rest of the movie, because after that it sort of felt like stuff didn't follow quite so much. You know,
really?
They could have just had, like, a rock fall on his leg and he... Like, that would have worked for me. It's like, oh yeah, he can't come with them because fucking he's paralyzed. But it's like, why does he stay behind? He's been, like, fighting forever.
Oh yeah, that's the thing. Didn't you catch that?
Oh yeah, I just
did you catch this amazing backstory of I've been fighting forever. Goodbye now.
Yeah, gotcha. We can't stop fighting the Empire. Oh, I'm too old now. Go on without
we
me.
We can't stop fighting the Empire. Yeah, come along. You know what? I kind of want to take a nap.
That's probably where because you know this was reshot heavily, right?
Oh, so, yeah. I totally knew about that going in.
Right.
Okay. How much of this was reshot?
The rumors are that it was, like, really heavily reshot. You know, it was a pretty different movie than when it started
like,
out to
you'll
be.
See a lot of, like, stuff in the trailers where it never made it into the film.
Yeah. I don't know. That was probably the clearest part where it was just like, all right, this character is meant to be way bigger than he ever was, which is fine, though. You know, honestly, like, because I ended up forgetting about that. Like, I was pissed off, too, and then I ended up forgetting about it, you know, through the second act, right? Like, by the time, what's the planet called? Is it Seraph? What's the planet that they actually have a fight on? Fuck. Whatever. I can turn to my nerd card now. Scarif. Whatever, that's
the one with, like, the big, like, stupid boss gate.
Yeah. It... As soon as we got onto Scarif, I just kind of forgot about the plot issues, you know? I was like, alright, well...
Hey, guys, spoilers!
Oh, yeah, sorry, spoilers.
No, I'm saying, like, yeah, let's keep talking about it, but we should probably say at some point... There are spoilers for Rogue One.
Yeah. So, like, honestly, I'm surprised you guys are as lukewarm on it, too, because, honestly, like, this
like,
movie...
Like, there are a
like,
lot of parts that I liked, but
yeah,
none
yeah.
of them
I think
are,
overall
like,
it's a solid movie.
Parts of the film, I guess.
Yeah. I think it's a good... I think it's a great film. I just don't... it's definitely not a Star Wars... Like, it's not a main episode Star Wars movie, which I guess is in a way is okay, but still, like... The reason why I liked Episode 7 so much, and so, like, I guess what I should say is that, like, everybody right now is like, oh my god, like, Rogue One's so great, it's, like, better than Episode 7, you know, like, way better.
Oh,
right?
Fuck
Because
off.
Right now, well, that's the thing, like, right now we're kind of in an anti-Episode 7 wave, you know, where, like, it's fine, like, Episode 7 had some real issues, I'm not gonna say it's the perfect movie or anything like that, but,
it was better than Rogue One.
I think I quite liked Episode 7.
Yeah, Okay, go ahead. All right. So basically, like, at the end of the day, like, Episode 7 for me was the stronger Star Wars film, just because, and that, I was grinning from ear to ear in that theater, like, the whole time. Like, I just fucking loved it, and I'm super attached to the new characters now. I can say that I'm very attached to any of the characters in Rogue One, you know, I didn't really...
Oh, I'm sorry, you mean the Dead Squad?
Yeah.
No one part
well,
of the
I mean,
Dead
no
Squad?
No one really cares fucking... about any of these characters, it's like...
Right.
Okay, I want to at least chime in on why I don't care, though.
Okay.
Because here's the thing, I know this director. Alright. Now, this is the asshat that ruined Godzilla, right?
Oh, you're salty about Godzilla. Got it. Okay.
Wait, which Godzilla? Like the 1996 one?
No. The new one.
Okay,
Brian Cranston.
I haven't seen that
yep.
one.
Yep, yep.
All right.
Okay. I should probably watch the Hideaki Anno Godzilla.
Yeah.
The guy's name is Gareth Edwards.
Yep.
All right. Now, to give you guys some context, I am a lukewarm Godzilla fan. I really enjoy the films. I'm not the biggest fan, and I'm willing to admit that. I know I'm not. So, here's the thing. When I watched that movie, right, Cranston, another Cranston film.
Oh, man. He keeps on going in shitty movies.
Yeah, no. Well, that's the thing, right? So, Cranston's the best part of that movie, and he's only in for the first 20 or so minutes. So, here's the thing, right? So I knew from the get-go that whatever we were going to get for this film was going to be probably the same as what I was expecting from Godzilla. So I went in there knowing that I was not going to go attached to the characters unless there was one, right? Unless there was one that I would have gotten attached to. And that, like, I feel it was going to get overblown. Just like Godzilla. That's exactly what I was thinking. Because here's the thing. Gareth Edwards knows how to, at the very least, pull off a really good conclusive or giant, like, climactic battle scene. That's what he's good at. When Godzilla's in town and he's wrecking shit and Blue Oyster Cult is writing a song about you, that's when you know, like, shit's going down. You know what I mean? But in Rogue One had the exact same thing. Like, that... 30-minute fight final climax scene is really solid. But I don't remember the name of the pilot. The guy who defected. I don't remember the name of the droid. And I don't remember the name of most of the characters except for Jin and Cassian, and it's because I wanted to like those characters. Jin seemed like a cool character, and so did Cassian. They both seemed kind of interesting, and they both were a darker side of the rebellion. But at the end of the day, I honestly think that direction is key, and I don't feel like... I was trying to explain this to Gang Widow earlier. There's a perfect scene that explains this. It's right after the dad dies, right? So they're on the ship, and they're trying to figure out exactly what's going on. And there is, like, no emotion, and I can't care for these characters. Because if there is emotion, it almost feels like it's diluted by something. Like, there should... War films fill you with a sense of emotion and attachment to those characters. That's what makes a good war film, you know?
Yeah, I don't know. I thought there was emotion there. I don't know. I thought there was... whatever. Keep going.
Oh, all I was going to say was, I'm thinking, it feels like Rogue One's trying to be too much of a bunch of things. It's trying to be a Star Wars movie, but also a war film. It's also supposed to be trying to please the fanboys, but also make it kind of... How do we sell this to kids as well? You know, like, there feels like there's too much going on.
I would argue the one thing that was kind of refreshing was that it wasn't trying to sell to kids. You know, you didn't get the BB-8 droid. You know, you didn't get any of the... You didn't get a CGI... All CGI cartoon character to latch onto, you know?
I don't know, the droid guy.
Yeah, the droid guy was snarky and he was comic relief, but he's not meant to sell toys.
To sell to, like, people in, like, you know, sort of college age, like...
Yeah, I think this is, like late high school, early college age. Yeah, exactly. I think that's what they were going for with this one.
His humor doesn't really necessarily work for kids as much.
Right. I mean, there's nothing wrong with targeting kids, you know.
I'm sure they're going to still try to sell it to kids. It's just the movie wasn't made for them.
Right. Yeah. There's parts of the movie that I actually really like, and I don't really have as much distaste as you seem to, Mitch. But I just.
Oh no, I still enjoy the film. I just think that it's a problem I'm starting to notice where it's like because something's part of a bigger continuity, people are kind of being more lax about things. Yeah. I still enjoyed it for what it's worth. It's still a film I'm glad I saw. I just need to address that there are issues.
Of course. No, there are. My main problem was the same as yours is that it's the characters. I walked out of that theater not really knowing half of the characters' names, you know, and for a Star Wars film, that's a pretty big failing. That's not what it was trying to do, you know what I mean? It didn't feel like they were trying to sell you on the characters so hard and it failed. Like, that would be even worse. It was just that the characters weren't as much of a focus, and that was a disappointing part to me. That's why I touched on the episode 7 thing, because people are shitting on episode 7, praising this to high heaven, and where I feel like there's strengths and weaknesses to both of them, you know?
Are there serious, I mean, yeah. Episode 7 had its weaknesses, but, like, they're saying that this was better than 7?
Yeah, it's a vocal minority, but it's definitely there.
Is it the same people who were like, oh, episode 3 was so darker and edgier than the other Star Wars films?
I don't know,
Wars
dude.
Films.
No one's really coming out to defend the prequels lately. I don't know, dude. It was just people with different... I'm happy that they're two different enough movies. I guess the main takeaway is that I'm glad that we have two different enough movies in the franchise that people can... There are different types of Star Wars fans to latch onto each one. And I'm also very glad that this was not a numbered episode. I would have been way more upset if it was an actual numbered episode. You know, if 8 was like this, then I'd be kind of pretty bummed. That being said, I think also what was really weird to me was that it was pretty much Halo Reach the movie. I guess neither of you guys have played Halo Reach.
I'm familiar with Reach,
but it's really kind of interesting. Yeah, because, like, so basically, Halo Reach was a prequel to Halo 1, where, like, Reach is the name of the planet where all the Spartans are on, and the climax of both Reach and Rogue One are pretty much the exact same in that your squad, you are literally, your main mission is to, you have Cortana, the main AI character from the Halo series, on a USB drive. You are trying to deliver it to the ship that, that Master Chief is on, and, you know, you're just, it's a suicide mission, and your crewmate's dying one by one, you know, and then you just barely make it to the ship to deliver the Cortana, and then you stay on the planet and die by yourself. And then the Covenant, the bad guys, show up and glass the planet. And then the shot, and the game ends with the same shot that Halo 1 begins on, with the Pillar of Autumn, the ship that Master Chief is on, like, discovering that, like, flying through deep space and finding the Halo. it's just really fun. It was just really kind of really uncanny how big the similarities are. And it's probably because, in all honesty, Halo 1 probably copied from A New Hope with its opening sequence, right? Like, with, like, you know, Covenant invading your ship and everything. You have to, you know, defend it. They were totally pulling from Star Wars there. It's just really cool that two franchises came full circle, like, with each other like that, you know? It was cool to see that. But that being said, walking out of the theater, I wasn't disappointed. I was satisfied. It was exactly as good as I thought it would be. Well, no, I shouldn't say exactly, but, like, it was. I got what I wanted and expected. But people were definitely overhyped it going in. You know, I ended up watching it about 3 weeks late. You know, like, so people are already watching and reacting to it. And they said, and, like, that's the thing. Like, I have a few friends that were, you know, like I said, that vocal minority. They didn't like 7, but they really liked Rogue One. They're like, oh god, it's so good. It's so, oh, it's way better. It's better than 7. And I'm like, wow, like, that's a high bar. But okay, like, I'll go in and I'll keep an open mind. And I was like, nope, not better than 7.
But still very good. What worries me the most is that, to me at least, like, the new Star Wars franchise hasn't proven to me that it can make a like, zero, like, withholdings, like, great film.
Like, 7
doesn't prove really? Anything to me because, you know, it's pretty much a remake. Like, they have the same elements. Like, Rogue One, to me, is, like, it's an imperfect film with enjoyable elements.
Yeah. I understand what you're saying. But I would call Episode 5, like, Empire Strikes Back, like, that's an unqualified great film, to me at least.
Yeah.
I feel like you could point to that, and I think that movie can hang its hat on its cinematography by itself, not just being, oh, it's great for Star Wars fans. Like, no, that's a great film. But
so I have a lot of bones to pick with Rogue One. It's I don't have anything against people who enjoy it at all, but it's like, yeah. Personally, I found the movie to be, it was enjoyable. It's like, but it was no more enjoyable to me than, say, watching, like, any other popcorn flick, like, fucking, if you remember this, like, one really obscure, forgettable, like, action movie from, like, 2005 called, like, The Marine, that featured, like, a weapon.
Oh my god!
Like, it's pretty much on that level, except with, like, 10 times more, like, production value.
Budget, yeah.
That's what I sort of rate this as. It's enjoyable. But at the same time, it's got a lot of flaws. And I think it's partially because this movie doesn't have the one thing that all good action movies need, and it's a sense of causality. Like, so what is the reason why everything's happening? Like, sure, everything's sort of building up to a certain point where it's, of course, you're going to get the stuff, like the plans for the Death Star. That's, like, what everybody sold to the film on. But at the same time, you don't have this, like, connective tissue that tells you, so this leads to this, that leads to this. It's not something that's super strong, like, in something like, I guess Terminator, where you've got, like, oh, so Terminator comes back in time, and you've got another person coming back in time. So you've got this sort of collision course between, like, the two mysterious entities that are coming towards, like, Sarah Connor, and then you've got all of these other actions that follow logically from that point. Star Wars Rogue One felt a lot like it was checkbox-driven in how they laid out the story, where it's like, okay, so we have to have cameo here, action scene here, we need to blow up, like, X number of Star Destroyers, and, oh yeah, at the end we need to, like, have Darth Vader, like, cutting through a whole bunch of people. That's awesome! That's great! But at the same time, it felt really artificial. And the first time that the artificiality sort of hit me was, like, It wasn't necessarily, like, after the guy died, but, or at the point where the guy died, that was, like, the rebellion leader. It was when everybody got back from the point where, like, Jin's dad died, and, like, they were all meeting up in, like, the, sort of meeting room for the rebellion, and I sort of got distracted by the editing in that scene, where it's, like, it felt like it was literally on a timer where they would go, like, 1, 2, 3 seconds cut, 1, 2, 3 seconds cut, 1, 2, 3 seconds cut, and then when I started paying attention to this, I looked at it and thought, so wait, why are they cutting? It's like, there's no reason for them to be cutting this much. It's like, it breaks the flow of the images, it makes it so that you can't, like, look at anyone's performances, it's just zooming in on people's faces, and it's like, shouldn't you just, like, put the camera on, like, a pintle and just have it sit there and watch everybody? Hmm. Like, there's no... Like, there's a lot of stuff, a lot of cruft, I guess, in the film that doesn't need to be there. And I feel like it would be a lot better if they just let the film be its own thing, I guess. And do... and, like, play to the strengths of the storyline that it was given. But yeah, that's my little, like, rant on Star Wars Rogue One.
No, I get it. Interesting. Your criticism's pretty... I haven't heard that one yet, actually. I don't know, a little bit more nuanced than what I can provide. But, I don't know. Overall, it's a really fun movie. I'm glad it's out there. You know, I'm not upset with its existence, but...
I'm glad it exists. I think... it's, like, it's fucking really good to see fucking AT-ATs and, like, fucking AT-STs running around.
Yeah, there's something really visceral about seeing those guys. Just
I disagree.
What the really? Fuck, Mitchell?
No.
I say something that's, positive.
That's my actual problem with it, oh. Right? AT-ATs, right? These giant fucking walkers that were in the opening scene to fucking, fucking Empire Strikes Back, right?
Yeah.
They're attacking the Hoth base. They're giant, powerful cannons that destroy, like, they're, like, they destroy tons of shit, right? Uh-huh. And the idea is, these things are fucking dangerous. They're intimidating, they're imposing and shit. So when we have that final moment, right, in the climax, why the fuck did the Empire put a bunch of them on their own fucking base? That always bothered me. That doesn't make sense to me.
I mean, I always figured they have it these, was like, one of those things where it's like, it's a garrison, where they just keep a whole bunch of them, and then they get them loaded up onto ships and ship them off somewhere.
Right, like, they gotta get transported somehow, right?
I guess, but, like, in my mind, somewhere in the back of my mind, all I can think to myself is, like, there was a lot of gross fan service in this film, and I can't help but notice it, and it sucks.
I guess.
Because...
I mean, we didn't need C-3PO and R2-D2 in the film.
We didn't need the hey, watch it, be careful, you'll be dead, I'm wanted on 12 systems, guy. Like, we didn't need that. you see what I mean?
I liked that. That was great. I forgot he was in there.
Like, some fan service I totally understand, and then some of it's like, oh my god, why?
I don't know. Like, I felt like that was pretty harmless, though. Like, you know, like...
Okay, let me put it this way. Some of it...
It could have been way worse. How about that?
I feel like they just needed a few fewer, like, callbacks.
Yeah, it's hard to do when you're making an interquel, though. You know, like...
and that's the thing. So, like, I will give them the AT-ST, right? I understand that. I understand. I completely get that. But, like, there's some tiny details... That just, like...
On crystal mining planet, right?
Just some small stuff. It was just some small stuff that, like, the inner Star Wars fanboy in me was like, oh my god, Mitchell, do you see this? And then I'm like, but kid Mitchell, though.
You know, a funny thing that just occurred to me, you know, so the Jedi use, like, crystal gems to, like, power their lightsabers, so it's the fucking, like, Death Star, like, powered by, like, a cluster, basically.
I was gonna say, does like the this like are they using like lapis lazuli and their fucking gem sabers?
Hmm.
God. That was a good way to explain like the sheer power of the Death Star. Actually, I will give them that too. Like yeah. That was a really cool way to be like, hey, what's the super crystals? Cool, powerful shit? Yeah, like, hey, guess who's not using these anymore? Guess what doesn't exist anymore?
Right.
The Jedi Order.
Right.
God. Okay. So, is there any closing thoughts you want to say about Rogue One, real quick?
I was just
thinking about that.
No, I'm really tired. It's good. If you haven't watched it, I recommend it. But
temper expectations. Yeah, Rogue One's pretty fun.
Sorry, we spoiled the whole thing for you, I guess. If you haven't seen it, but you know the ending already.
Yeah, that's actually another thing.
Everybody dies. The end.
Well, it was kind of one of those. It was one of those things where it was just like, oh yeah, I guess it's like watching any prequel movie where it's like, well, you know, whatever happens, like nothing super bad can happen.
You know what though? I think there were some really genuinely like standout moments in Rogue One.
Yeah.
Like aside from just like the fan service, it's like the point where the droid is like BT.
No, KT.
BS. Okay, it's
something. It's not BT. BT is K, BT is K, Titanfall.
Oh.
K2SO.
Oh, K2SO.
K2SO.
Like, where he like grabs that like thermal detonator out of the air and like throws it back at the stormtroopers. It's like, and then he just makes like this like really like offhand comment. And it's like that was probably in the original cut of the film. And it's like I thought that was really winsome. I thought, ah, man.
No, like those scenes are quite great. Like most like. The scenes with the fallen Jedi Temple and everything like that, that was interesting stuff, you know? And,
like, I liked like, the entire, like, their entire visit to, like, the, like, temple area. I thought that was great.
Alright, yeah. Like, okay, so overall consensus, for the Velvet Room consensus seems to be Rogue One, it's a pretty good film for what it's worth, but it's not without its faults.
Sure.
So,
yep.
Yeah, that I feel like that's a good way of
putting it. Don't expect it to be Saving Private Ryan. Don't expect it to be, like, you know...
Star Wars Episode 8.
The mainline, like, Star Wars films.
Yep.
Yeah, go... And don't watch Godzilla if you haven't already. because that might ruin some things for you.
And don't try to hold grudges, yeah. Director grudges.
Don't hold grudges against past directors for their follies of teasing that, Bryan Cranston.
That being said, if M. Night Shyamalan gets anywhere within a 10-foot radius of the Last Airbender series, I'm gonna fucking kill him.
No, he gets this series. He gets Star Wars.
Oh, no! No!
The twist is Kylo's Ren's dad.
What? Oh.
Or Rey's dad.
Rey's dad. Kylo's Ren's dad.
Oh, you know, it's what? Relativity. He gets on a ship and goes near light speed.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I
used the mini-chlorians to all right, manipulate fucking, the will of the let's, past force.
We're done. Let's move on.
How long can you
gotta keep
moving? All right. So... We also have here, so Josh and I talked about the Steven Baum already in a different video that is either out now or will take some time to get to.
Yeah.
We talked a bit about it already, but, Sora, what were your thoughts on the Steven Baum?
Oh, it was really good. I liked it. It was, am I allowed to spoil? Am I allowed?
Yes, absolutely.
Really?
Yes.
Because they're not out yet. I don't know. I feel bad, but
whatever. We have a great topic for this too.
Okay.
Yes.
Fine.
So yeah.
Anyways.
So
yeah.
Spoilers. I really liked seeing Blue Diamond. I'm glad we got to see more of her. They handled the. I really liked the episode where Greg friend zones all of the humans in the zoo and they all freak out. that was cool. I liked his little speech about that. Like that, damn. And then the kind of the implication that they bubbled every single fucking rose quartz because our rose quartz shattered Pink Diamond.
Oh, wait, were those rose quartzes?
Those were all rose quartzes. That's yeah. They're all in the same shape as Steven's gem. So yeah.
Really? Oh shit!
Yeah.
I didn't notice that.
Yeah, that was not a detail we picked out. Actually.
Really? Yeah. No. All of the gems in the bubbles were rose quartzes, and the yellow diamond said in passing, like, I don't know why you're keeping these gems all bubbled. You should just shatter them. Yeah, lots of big things, you know, definitely pretty big game changers. I still don't really understand the crying. Like, why was Steven crying? Was that rose quartz crying, or is that blue diamond? Was that him reacting to blue diamond sadness? Like,
from my understanding, and it was something we talked about in the video a bit. The idea is Steven has, or it seems to be implied that Steven has a unique connection to gems because of his state.
Right.
Because, like, in his dreams, he visited Lapis because he was trying to find her, right?
Right, right, right.
And then, like, you know, in other scenarios, he can feel the intensity of gems and communicate to even things like the cluster. So I assume that this ability is just, like, sympathy or, like...
ultra sympathy with Blue Diamond, then. So he has a connection with Blue Diamond, then.
Yes,
okay,
yes.
Got
so it's like... Like, some people are interpreting it as, he has unique connections to specific gems, but I'm interpreting it as, because of Rose and just his state and what he is, he just can feel
ultra empathy. Got it. Okay.
Yes, yes.
All right. So yeah, overall, really solid bomb. Bummer that it got leaked early. I'll try to support the show officially. I bought a Steven Universe t-shirt, so they got $20 out of me, I guess. But
that sweet, sweet $20 will buy the crew crackers.
Yeah. So, you know, whatever. Very happy with it. Pumped for the future. I need more episodes now. Please give them to me. I'm never satisfied.
Oh. Like a crack addict.
Yeah, dude.
Oh my god. Okay, so now we can talk a little bit about what happened, because we covered this a little bit in the video, but we're going to tell you right now. This was an official release.
Right.
This was an official release that happened. So the news was spread that essentially that this was a leak, and that's why everyone was freaking out, because what the hell just happened? But as it turns out, this was released through Cartoon Network's own app that's available on mobile devices. And the idea is that, hey, if you have this app, you can sometimes magically, if you wish hard enough, you can obtain episodes, you know, apparently a month in advance. So as part of a promotional tool for this app, they released this. And thinking to themselves, hey, people are going to watch this on the app because it's an official way to watch it. And, I mean, what are the odds that people are going to, you know, pirate it from this source on a mobile phone?
That's just, I don't know, I don't really, I don't want to accuse Crunchyroll of not, or not Crunchyroll, wow, Cartoon Network of not knowing what they have, but it just doesn't seem like they really understand the kind of fan base that they're dealing with here, you know?
I don't think they, no, to be honest, I honestly don't think they do, actually.
Like, I knew about this platform at all before he discovered this article talking about it.
Like, it was in the middle of the recording when we found out the news. And it's a very real problem. I mean, we will see the damage the week after. We will see the damage that it will have and the impact it's going to have, and hopefully this is a wake up call, because by God, was this not the right thing to do
yeah.
in this situation?
Oh well, hopefully live and learn, right? I don't know.
I'm really hopeful. I'm really hopeful that that's the case. Because to be honest with you, this feels like a giant blunder, and maybe I sound a bit harsh about this. It just, I would hate for a series, not even Steven Universe. I would hate for a series to go through something like what the Crewniverse did or had to go through with this, because essentially, from my understanding, not a lot of people were told about this.
Right.
I mean, so what I draw from this is that, like, it's problematic because, you know, technically it's an official release before, like, the official air date for, like, the TV air date. And, yeah, that's all good and fine, but at the same time, since it's on a platform that pretty, like, literally nobody uses... Like, I can't imagine anybody who's using it, because, like, it seems to have gotten zero advertisement anywhere. It just got released
on pretty much every like online streaming platform, like illicit online streaming platform out there. And what this leads to is it could lead to a slight dip in the TV watching, like the TV watching audience, which in turn like would result in people evaluating it and saying like, oh, people aren't watching this. What should we do about the show? And then if this happens too much, you know, like you roll this over and over, it turns into, okay, so the show is up for renewal. Do we renew it? No, we don't, because the revenue's down. And it makes me mad because it's like, this is still like a corporate decision to put it on this platform that nobody's using and not letting people know about it. And then it's also another corporate decision, probably, to evaluate it and say that it's no good and we don't want to do it anymore for, like, the show. And it's stuff that, when I think about it, it frightens me because I've heard stories like this before. And I don't know if it's ever going to change, really. But hopefully, like, they will do something about this if it's enough. Though, honestly, because, like, the Steven Universe, like, fandom is so big and so wide, we might not see very much of a difference in, like, the viewership numbers when the time comes for the bomb.
Well, we'll see what happens. Like, I feel like ultimately, 2 weeks from now, we'll cover the material if there is anything to cover. That's how I'm looking at it. Like this absolutely 100% sucks. Like, this is a really bad thing that happened. But for all we know, the bad thing might not happen.
Yeah, we can hope.
So, I honestly want to believe that things will just turn out okay. Yeah, so that's pretty much the Steven Bomb talk. If you want to hear the rest of that, Josh and I did a little bit of that earlier. So, whatever comes out first. That being said, I think this is a good place to stop the cast for this week because we are reaching the 2 hours.
Oh, we just hit 2 hours. Oh, nice.
We just hit 2 hours. So we are going to be start taking some questions in the podcast questions section of the Discord.
Need to handle the ones that have already been put out too, because we do have those pinned ones from a long time ago.
So how can I see the pinned ones, Josh?
So go to that section and then there should be like a little thumbtack icon at the top.
Oh, okay. Alright, so the first question comes from Miss Enter Your Name, which is Oceano. Oceano asks, how long did it take to write your book? Oh, this is very specifically for me. it took a year. It's still actively a thing too, because I'm still currently in the I'm still currently writing. So, are not writing, but editing right now. So it's a very real process that I'm working through with you guys, and I'm posting on the Discord. If you guys aren't aware, I did write a book called Rockstar, Rockstar, because I'm a dweeb, and I post bits and snippets of it on the Discord. So if you're ever interested, let us know, and I'll Anyways, that's the answer to that. What is the thing you look for most in a story? Ask Water Tiger. So I'll let you guys answer this one first.
What is the thing you look for most in a story? Yes. Probably, this is such a generic answer, but some sort of character to latch onto, you know, whether that's somebody that's relatable or somebody that I feel like is really well written, or, you know, something, it's a character that is clearly showing has some sort of potential to be developed on, you know, that has a potential to be dynamic. And then if not that, then a really strong world building, you know, something that I can, like, as far as like with books and it tends to happen more with books, but if I can get myself transported to a universe that has set rules and, you know, certain style to it, then yeah, that's what I look for, I guess. Pretty generic, but yeah.
I guess for me, it's, a really strong hook. Like, I will gladly consume a shitty story if it has an initially interesting idea. Which, it's something that I don't really like about my habits with consuming media, but it's like, if you've got something that's legitimately interesting to me, like, I will more than gladly give the story, like, more than, like, its fair shake, I guess.
The thing I look for most in a story is character interaction. There is nothing that makes me happier than seeing good, well-done character interaction. Good writing is a really solid thing for me. It's honestly the make or break. Like I said in Passengers and other things, like, the thing that makes a good movie or a good piece of media is just understanding how certain personality types and certain, like, thought, like, how do I word this? Just watching people interact in a really interesting way is always cool, you know? It's a cool way to handle, like, storytelling. So, yeah. The next one... Hang on a second. The next one comes from Jotaro Kujo, and he asks, if you have any video game character or an anime character you think that would best fit in Overwatch, who would it be, and what would their abilities be?
Oh... That's a really hard question.
You guys, that response is very real.
Anime or video game character? Fuck. Alright, I say we make it only anime character. There we go.
Oh, okay.
That makes it a little easier.
Oh, okay.
Right. Because video games would make it too easy because they already have mechanics.
Oh, that's real. No, that's valid.
Shit. Oh, okay. Man.
this is the sound of constipation of the mind.
Yeah, no, do you want to think of another... Do you want to answer another question while I ruminate on this for a little bit? Cause...
Let's keep going, I guess, in the meantime.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, while we try to solve this one, okay.
Yeah.
It's another Overwatch-related question. What Overwatch skin would you want?
Granted, we have to put out that this came out... This question was from, like... December 18th.
Yeah, wow, we're really digging, guys. Like, this is a lot of questions we're going to get through here.
So this was while the Christmas event was going, and...
Oh, okay, yeah. So, Water Tiger asked this one, I wanted the Tracer skin, and I got it.
I wanted the fucking... the Zenyatta, the Nutcracker one, and I did not get it. I didn't get any fucking Christmas skins. The only cool thing I got...
Oh, really?
No.
Oh, wow.
Well, that's the thing, dude. Like, I went home, you know... For Christmas, for, like, you know, half that break, you know. Well, half that break was, like, me getting started on my... I don't know. It was just a really busy month for me, you know. Yeah, so I just wasn't able to play Overwatch that much as I wanted to, so... Nope. Even in the five free boxes, all I got was the Widow intro. So, salty about that. Thanks for reminding me. Fuck! No, I'm just kidding. But, yeah, I would have wanted the Nutcrackers and Yada skin, but... And I was really... I almost bought some loot boxes, but I was like, eh, it's not worth it. For me, at least. Yeah.
Okay.
I wanted the Winston skin.
I guess I'll start the next question. God.
I want a psychopath character in Overwatch, but I don't know how you would get the Dominator mechanic to go work. You know what I mean? Like, that's what I'm trying to figure out right now. You know, like, because
the Destroy would totally be the fucking... ultimate.
The ult? Yeah. But it would have to take a while to charge. Like, maybe it could be, like, an automatic kill, but I don't know if I'd like an automatic kill in Overwatch. I guess we're taking it a little too seriously.
So you have the stun, and you have the,
You have a stun. You would have to have some sort of psychopath mechanic in it, though, right?
Like, yeah, you'd have to read it. Crime coefficient.
You need line of sight for all these things.
Maybe they have, like...
No, you have to catch them after they fucking kill somebody.
Oh yeah! There you go.
Yeah,
their crime coefficient goes up.
Your ult will be an insta kill.
It's an anti-streak character, you know. When somebody's going on a tear, their crime coefficient goes up, you know. And then, oh wow.
Maybe okay. In proportion to like how much damage they've done.
How much damage they've done? Sure. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. The numbers that you get when, like, you know, whenever, like, you know, you say, like, got 82% of that kill, you get the 82 skull or whatever, that's just your crime coefficient adding up, bro. That's all that is. So Sorry, we're talking, Felipe, we're talking about what anime character we'd have in Overwatch, so I'm thinking psychopath's character, so I guess, you know, Akane Tsunemori, I guess, or Kogami, but I want Akane, she's my favorite. Yeah, there you go, that's my answer.
Shit, yeah, I'm good, having a really fucking good. Hard time, because fucking a lot of the characters that I would choose would sort of already be in the game, like fucking Jigen Daisuke from, like, Lupin the Third would totally be McCree.
Yeah, yeah.
Goku Dera Hayato from Katsukiyo Hitman Reborn
is just Junkrat.
Yeah, exactly. Oh god.
Let's see. Let's pull up a list of my.
Do we want another? Do we want another?
Yoshikage Kira.
Kira Queen. Yeah, let's do it. Let's bring Stan into fucking Overwatch. Fucking that's what we
need. Overwatch. Freeze the entire game for everybody.
It's slow moving air bubbles that you can vaguely see.
What's his ult? Bites are dusto. It has to be.
Like, and the payload moves back.
Yes.
A bit.
No. Bites the dust would be like if you kill him, he mercy ults himself.
Yes, Yatazo, and he like travels back. Oh man, yeah, it's so fucking good.
Adds more time to the clock.
Yeah, dude. But yet everybody respawns, but then you still die at the same timestamp unless he activates it.
Oh, that's crazy.
Yeah,
that's cool.
Yeah, it's also bullshit and impossible to balance around, but it's really cool.
You know what you do? You make it so that, like, he has to get his ult, like, three times to activate it once.
Right. And then once it's set, you can't use your abilities at all because you have to set... Because, like, that was the catch, right? Like, Killer Queen was embedded in Bites the Dust, right? So...
Yeah, yes, yeah, exactly.
There you go.
So that's, yeah,
that's exactly still not that balanced, but it's getting there.
it's a small change...
Yeah.
When Reinhardt's hammer smashes into him. Oh my god. So I guess Killer Queen, Yoshikage Kira, would be it. You cannot do Dio. Like, I thought about it. I had to think about it for a second. Like, he would throw a knife, but then it's like, stopping time as an ability is garbage.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Because the whole game would have to stop.
Yep. All right. Okay, and we need to move on to another question.
Yep, pretty much.
All right. Yeah. No. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. So that goes into if you could have anyone be the voice of Doomfist from Overwatch, who would it be and why?
I mean, honestly, I'm hard pressed to find another person that's better than Terry Crews for the role. You know.
Yeah no, Terry Crews.
That's a really shitty answer. I know, but
like the Doomfist character.
Right, like, I just don't know enough about him, but, like, seeing his picture, yeah, that's fucking Terry Crews, you know, like, I don't know, like, I don't know who else you'd want to pick, maybe Danny DeVito,
No, okay, here's the thing, ultimate answer is Terry Crews, super ultimate answer is Idris Elba.
Oh, my god, yes, I didn't think of that, yep, fuck. Never mind, Idris Elba, for sure.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
No, I changed my
mind. What was his fucking like line in like Pacific Rim from his speech?
We are canceling the apocalypse.
Yes.
Yeah. Fuck yeah! All right. Yeah, Idris Elba. Fuck yeah.
He's on like a fucking like.
Sorry, Terry. I love you, but
we are canceling the apocalypse. He ults and like team kills the attacking team.
And then the Pacific Rim theme plays. Da 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 da.
No, his ult is.
Yeah.
His ult is a call mech, and then a fucking Jaeger flies out of the sky.
One of his voice lines is like, "That's a dangerous gypsy."
Oh my god. Yeah, yeah. That's what. That's a line to Diva. Yeah. When he says Diva's
mech. And then
you
know you can have fucking like great like voice line interaction between him and Diva.
Yep. Okay. All right. He just all his Doomfist. Right. Perfect.
Yeah, all right. So next, Josh, anyone that you wanted to add before I get to the next question?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay. Oceano asks, this question is for y'all, which is your favorite Final Fantasy game?
Oh, man, you've just launched another podcast topic, my friend.
There's a part of me that's like, let's put this on the back burner for next week.
We can elaborate on it further, but I mean, we know each other's already. Mine is Final Fantasy VI.
Mine is Final Fantasy 2.
What?
No, it's 10, it's 10, 10.
Who the fuck's played 2?
I'm sure Mitchell has played 2.
Yeah, no,
oh my god.
Anyways, Josh.
The only one I've actually played is 10, so it's mine by default. Though okay. I have to say, I do honestly really like 10.
15 is slowly but surely working its way into my heart.
You're liking it, you're liking it.
I did give it another chance. That's another thing I did in the week. I did play a little bit more, so there is a bit more there. It doesn't hurt the fact that I am constantly like seeing awesome pictures online.
Yeah.
Like I watched Brotherhood with Mad, and like I'm also like Gangudo and I are talking about like, man, do you want to get into Boy Band Simulator 2016? Like, yeah, dude, and like I'm at a point where I'm like, man, I could make a really cool indie fan trailer, like for fucking 15, like I think that could be fun or something. But like, yeah, it's getting there. It's building itself up a little bit. But yeah, that being said, I'll let's end this on one last question. We received a shit ton of them. So, we're gonna end this on, what do you think of the live-action movies people make from unpopular anime shows, for example, Dragon Ball Evolution?
I mean, isn't Dragon Ball Evolution, like, objectively a terrible movie? I don't know.
Oh, okay, well,
it's about as good as the Power Rangers movie is going to be.
Okay, I'm gonna answer this, like, the way that I'm pretty much, my thoughts on this kind of thing. I hate saying it like this, but Taikubo put it the best. Out of all the authors I could have picked, there's a really great interview with Taikubo explaining why there would never be a live-action Bleach film. He wanted to make a story that could only be done in the form of manga, he felt. Manga and anime. That's his media, the medium that he picked. Certain things work for certain mediums. That's just how it works. Assassin's Creed is probably a better game than it was a movie. As far as I can tell, some of the Star Wars comics aren't that great. It works better as a movie, honestly. Or even a television show. I guess it depends on who's behind it and how much you're willing to compromise, because games are meant to last for hours and hours and hours, and it's supposed to be a giant time consuming form of entertainment, right? Movies are about 2 hours at most now, or 2 hours at most. Like, it, and even then that's kind of pushing it. Like, hour and a half maybe is a good even number.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of information you gotta fit in. And how many times are we gonna see bad, like, live action things before we realize that there is a certain amount we have to rewrite to make it work? And even then, it's not gonna be anything like the original source material. Like,
I mean, I guess we'll have to wait for Marvel... Ghost in the Shell.
Well, that's another thing, right? Ghost in the Shell's coming up, but I'm thinking also, like, the Marvel franchise right now, like, as much as the Marvel films are doing, like, having that time to read the comics, it's like, oh shit, these are great on their own. Like, if Marvel movies were just movies and didn't have the comic backing, it's actually a pretty solid movie franchise with a lot of interesting ideas. But the minute I started reading the comics, it's like, holy shit, they actually, like, Civil War was an eye-opener for me, honestly. As to how much, like, how different the comics were. And that, I feel like when you do something like that, where you make a live-action segment that is just radically different, yes, you're gambling on this idea, but it's also a chance to make something more interesting or something cooler or something that, like, is at least more entertaining to watch.
Mm.
So, but unfortunately, the ultimate truth of the matter is a lot of people have shit the bed on a lot of these attempts, and, yeah, it's put a sour taste in everyone's mouth.
Right, which is why I'm, like, really freaked out by the Death Note movie, but hey, who knows, maybe they...
Oh, no, that director really worries me, actually.
Yeah.
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 Fuck.
Oh, well.
I mean, that said, you know, there are some okay adaptations, but it's usually for stuff that, like, would work in live action anyways. Like, you know, a lot of shoujo series get along fine becoming, like, J-dramas.
You know what? I will say this much. I noticed that a lot of manga become really good dramas, actually.
It's like... I think part of it is also because, like, it's part of the reason why we don't have so many shoujo anime getting released anymore. Because it's probably more economical to, like, shoot it as a drama.
Yeah. I'll also say that, that being said, despite everything, I will admit that, like, I'm trying not to hype myself up for the, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure live action.
Oh, man.
So, and my only thing is, like, I know that some people are upset that it wasn't part 3 being done, to which my answer is, it's probably easier and cheaper to film part 4 than it is to go around the world.
Yeah,
and
but,
do
like,
all that
still,
stuff.
Like, that's so...
You know, there
part
is
4
one,
is still not going to be cheap to film. Like, how the fuck animated. Are they going to do stance? Like, it's just...
Oh, they're going to do it the way that the live-action Attack on Titan film deal.
And the live-action Death Note one in Japan with Ryuk, I guess? I don't know.
Yeah, have any of you guys watched the Cassern live-action movie?
I've heard some good things about it.
I've shown you a scene of it. Like, it's pretty much like MGR, the movie.
Oh my god.
I actually recommend it. It's a weird movie, but I think it's probably one of my favorite, like, adaptations of, like, an anime to live action. It's got this one rock track in it that I've been looking for forever, but fucking, it's impossible to find the OST for this thing.
Joke's on you, it's gacked. No,
it's totally gacked.
It's fucking gacked. Yeah, but, like, alright, guys, I think that pretty much sums everything up. We've been going about this for about, 2.5 hours now? So, yeah, let's start closing up. So, next time on The Velvet Room!
Woo!
Thanks for listening, guys.
Yeah, an end of another great podcast. No. Tune in, guys, next Sunday for another episode of the podcast. What were you gonna say, Josh?
Oh, yeah, I was just gonna say, you know, we do record these live on Discord in, like, the podcast recording room for anyone who's interested in, like, joining us.
Oh, yeah.
And we can all be, like, dweebs all together while we do this.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm actively trying to find ways to make it so that we can do this on Twitch.
It is the fastest way of watching, or listening to the podcasts.
Yeah.
There is a little bit of lag time between, like, when we record these and when we get them up. So, you know, if you're really hankering for this stuff, come to our Discord. Join us.
Yeah. Rock and roll, Josh. And that also being said, keep an eye out, because we're going to be doing some changes around the channel in terms of the upload schedule. I know that we've been really lax lately with everything. You guys get about, like, a couple streams a week and then, like, one or two uploads. We're going to try to get back on schedule. There's just been so much stuff that happened. And a lot of it boils down to just setting up new stuff on the computers and everything and all that.
Oh, yeah, Mitch has, like, a new computer now.
Yeah!
I can play PC games. You know, you guys should totally buy me games.
Yeah!
Don't actually do that.
No, please don't. Please don't actually do it. But, and I was gonna say, like, oh yeah, I'll totally work more on making sure the Twitch works, and then it's like, no, I'm going to a concert on Thursday. I've been wanting to go see this band for a while now, actually.
We expect to hear about this on the next Velvet Cast.
Oh, dude, you know it. Dude, you fucking know it. I've been looking forward to seeing the Cloud Nothings for, like, a long time. I am punk garbage, is what I was called today.
Huh,
I'm
garbage?
I'm slowly but surely turning into punk garbage, because it's my hairstyle nowadays, like the fucking red flannel.
That's true. Oh, yeah. That's true, man. Wow, you're rocking it. Last one out to Beach City.
Oh. I hate what I've become. No,
nah, that's true punk rock right there.
Oh, man.
Yeah, no.
Actual punk.
Yeah.
Not pretend punk.
Yo,
Because I'm so excited because I've been saving up my money and I finally have enough to get a guitar lately. I'm so excited.
That's awesome, dude.
Oh my god, new instruments, new fun. All right, next time on The Velvet Room.
Woo! Woo.
Bye.
See you guys. The Rum Ham.